What up, my people? Welcome to the League Talk Podcast. I'm your host, Shane Youman. Joining me on this episode is a very, very special guest. This man is a two-time MLB All Star, two-time Gold Glove Award winner, three-time National League Stolen Base champ from the great state of Texas, by way of H-Town, coming down, Mike Bourn.
What's up, man?
What's the deal, bro? What's the deal,
baby? What's going on, Shane, man? Thank you for having me, my brother. Thank you for having me.
Oh, man, I'm glad you jumped on, bro. I had to have a little fun with this little intro, bro, because you being from Houston, you know the music and the culture of Houston, Texas, the slang and stuff like that, man. It was real cool with me growing up, and it's still alive today out there. So I had to do something. You spent
some of the time down here with us, man. You know how we get down.
For sure. And growing up in Louisiana, you know, we listen to that Texas music as well.
We do the same with y'all. You know what I mean? We on the Juvenile, the Master P, the Bird. We on all of them. You know, we've been on Hot Boys since I was a little boy. So I was 15, really. But yeah, we've been on that too. So it goes both ways. That's love both ways. Plus, I got family from Louisiana. So
yeah.
Yeah, it goes like that.
You know how it go, man. It's a short trip too, man. So again, like I said, I appreciate you hopping on, man. This is the League Talk Podcast. So, you know, we're going to dive into your career, your journey into making it to the league. But first off, man, you know, these quarantine times, you know, we all sitting at the crib. I know playing ball, a lot of times we didn't have to go to the field till about 1-2 o'clock in the afternoon. So we sitting in the crib most of the day sleeping in. It's a little different now because you really can't go nowhere. So tell me how you and the fam been handling the quarantine and since this COVID-19 hit a few months ago.
Well, I mean, you know, COVID-19 is obviously a big part of life now. Tough on you, you know, try to practice social distancing, try to keep up with the numbers. One thing I try to do is keep my immune system up. You know, I try to find different ways to work out, different ways for my kids to work out now, because obviously, like you said, in March is when everybody started, you know, going crazy, you know, wondering what was going on. So my son didn't get to play baseball, and I took him out of baseball. So I kind of find ways to work him out, give him a little break.
Yeah.
And, you know, be a kid. I'm real big on that. Find ways to take my daughter to places, or, you know, spend some time with her, go outside. She likes to play.
Gotta be creative, huh?
I've been blessed. So I have a pool in my house, and I'm go out there, take them swimming, get some workouts like that. And, you know, we just do different stuff. Jump on the trampoline. I go upstairs and play the video game with him every now and then when he wants. Now he don't want to play. When he was younger, I was cool. And now I'm like, you know, nah, you can't. I got my friends to play with now. So I still let him have friends over here and there. It's just not all the time. You know,
yeah.
Do the best you can, man. You know, we're learning about it just like I think a lot of these doctors are learning about it. Like, it's new to everybody. So we're just adjusting accordingly.
Yeah, man, it's been a crazy few months here, bro. And like you said, just being creative, trying to stay busy with the young kids because they got a lot of energy. You got to try to find a way to burn it off, man. But, you know, that's definitely cool to be creative with that. And having the luxury of a swimming pool and some of the things that you're able to afford by having a nice, successful big league career. During these times, man, it's coming in handy to have a nice crib and some surroundings where you can actually get outside and do some stuff. And before we continue, man, I want to salute you, bro, on what you did with your tenants at your apartment complex. I saw something on Twitter where you helped them out with the rent. I think you waived the rent for a month or so that they can get back on their feet, man. You know, that's a huge thing, bro, that people don't look back at when folks need help in times like this. So again, I want to salute you for doing that for those tenants at your apartment complex.
Thank you, man. I just, you know, I felt the need to do it because just, you know, I've been blessed in my career. You know, I made some pretty good money in my career. So I'm like, man, you know, I knew I owned those apartment complexes. I'm like, man, you know, I don't own like the top apartment complex in the city, the high rise or nothing like that. But they're nice apartments that people can live in and, you know, make their day-to-day. But, you know, like, I also know that, like, with that happening, people are getting laid off jobs. You know, kids are out of school. They need more food. You know, they're not sending them to school where they're eating at school every day and eating 2 or 3 meals a day. So that's back home, you know. People need gas to take different places, but they don't have that out at work to make their money. So
yeah.
I don't know every one of my tenants, to be honest with you, but I do know that I do know that they need their money for different things. And I just, you know, I felt it in my heart to do it. I just did, and I did it for 2 months, and I was able to make it to where they're able to use their money for something else. You know, I feel like that was a thing to do, and, you know, it was just on my heart to do it. So I reached out and did it, made it happen.
For sure, that's huge, man. That's a way of giving back to the community. You know, if you don't look at it in that sense, of course, you're the landlord. You want to be able to make your money when you can, but you also have to show some compassion, especially at a time like this. So speaking on the pandemic that we started with back in March to a pandemic that's been going on for years and years and years, over 400 years, and we talking about the mistreatment of blacks, more so nowadays by cops, but just that society that looks at us and still see us as less of. You have a young son that's 11 years old, well, about to be 11 years old, right, Bryce, and then you have a daughter that just turned 7. Man, it's tough growing up in these times, and yourself included, and your wife. You guys have to be careful going outside now. You live in a nice neighborhood, but you still got to watch your back, and it's crazy these days to where it's some folks out there you can't really trust, and the one group that we are having those problems with more so than anything now is cops. So speak on how you feel about things and how they're going right now. I know there's a lot of change that's being worked on. But having a son that's 11, he's about to get into his teen years, and he has a lot of friends. They like to hang out and stuff like that. Have you had a talk with your son or your daughter about what's going on right now and how society has been treating us as a whole when it comes to the black community?
Well, the crazy thing about it is that he knows about it because he's seeing it all on TV. It's everywhere. There's no way you can hide it from him.
Yeah.
I'm not the one that's trying to hide it from him. So, you know, I also think that, you know, like, I'm not a person that's, like, trying to tell him not to have friends of other races, or, you know, not to be friends with people that's, you know, just not in the white race, you know, in the Asian race, in the Mexican race, whatever race it is, you know. Like, yeah. I've seen Stephen Jackson say something that's real critical to me, and he puts it, he says, we have love, who has love for all, you know. Those are the people we have love for. We just don't like the people that treat us because the color of our skin is black, that you treat us like we shouldn't be, you know, we're not worthy, you know, and like it's the, you're judging the book by its cover. You don't even know these people, and, you know, yeah. you're taking stuff out on them. You know, it could be a young man walking with dreads, or however he chooses to wear his hair, you know, but he could be the smartest dude on the block, or smartest dude ever.
Exactly.
But you're judging him because the way he wears his hair. You're not judging, you're not trying to get to know him. And, you know, we've all been through it at some point, you know. Like, I've seen it happen on different occasions, you know, like a whole bunch of different occasions. Getting on the elevator, somebody might not want to get on the elevator with you, that's white, and it's like, you know, you have no clue who I am, but I'm not
yeah.
crazy like that, you know, but it's happened to me, you know. But, you know, you look at it and you just shake your head. But, I mean, I think one thing about it is like, man, you know, 400 years of what's been going on, it's not going to break in like 6 months. You know what I mean? Like, it's going to take some time for this to grow. And one thing about it is that we're still going to have people that just don't like us.
Of course.
That's going to be. That's not going to go anywhere. But those that do, and those that are trying to understand, you know, hopefully they'll be on our side and roll with us, you know, like. That's just the way it is, you know. I don't feel like we should be not worthy of something because of our color. That's no way that should happen. So for our ancestors, you know, that was way before us, the things that they had to go through, getting sprayed by water hoses, getting bit by dogs, getting attacked and beat just for no reason, getting hung, man, like, that's a different ball game, you know. And, you know, people don't understand it until it was happening to their race. We understand it because it always happened to our race. So, you know, the other race, you know, somebody white might not understand, that's like that, might not understand it because, you know, they haven't had to deal with that, you know. But one thing I think is very important is that you have to have the conversation. You know,
sure.
I believe the conversation has to be had. So you sit across from somebody and have the conversation on what's going on and how we feel, and let's move forward. You know, if you're not having a conversation, it does nothing. You know, we can sit here and say we want change, but we got to have a conversation, help you on, you know, you got to understand. If you want to understand, you know, you have to want to understand first, but then, you know, I feel like, you know, you really have to have that conversation. You know, that's a big thing. Now, some people are not going to want to understand.
Nah.
You know, that's just how it is. It's just simple as that, you know. But, I mean, you know, playing baseball, we know, you know, we was only 8% baseball, so we know already, you know. So,
yes.
You know, the dude Bruce Maxwell, you know, he's the first one to take a knee in baseball. And, you know, the next year he was done.
He was gone.
He was gone to Mexico, you know, one of the top prospects in the Oakland A's organization. But because he did that, it's like, you know, they, nobody ever gave him a chance again. Now, he also got a, you know, I think he had another run-in with the police, but it wasn't nothing that's like crazy. You know, I just feel like he should got another chance. You know, everybody deserves a second chance, you know. Nobody's perfect in this world.
Of course. I'm with you, man. And the fact that your son sees it, he knows what's going on and probably understands a little bit, that's tough, man. I mean, because it's a worldwide thing.
Take it like this. I heard CeCe Sabathia say something that was very interesting and very good to me. It's like his son is 16 right now, 16 or 17, and he's teaching him how to drive. You know, when you teach your son how to drive, you're worried about him running a stop sign.
Yeah.
You know, make sure
driving too fast.
Driving too fast, you know, not paying attention, you know, watching out for the police if they're behind you, like with the lights on, they need to get out the way. But instead, he's having to have a conversation with, if you get pulled over, get your hands on the steering wheel. Make sure you answer, no, sir, yes, sir. Because as a father, you don't want nothing to happen to your son. So for a black man to have that with his son, like, I know that's not happening in other cultures like that. Especially like white cultures. No way that's happening like that in the white culture. We having to actually tell our sons, like, hey, when you get pulled over, make sure you yes sir, no sir, got two hands on the wheel. Make sure you know you got your license out and your insurance card out. Make sure you got all that. That's crazy to even have to have that conversation, but you have to have it, you know. And it's appalling to me, man. I mean, like, I just hope some things change, man. It's just some things that need to be changed. You know?
Yeah, it's bizarre to say the least, man. When you think about that, you know, instead of telling them how to pull over. As far as if you get stopped, it's telling me, hey, you pull over, make sure that A, B, C, and D, you do that. And even still.
Yes, exactly.
Shit might still happen. Exactly. You know what I'm saying?
Yes, it's our sisters, man. The black sister, like Breonna Taylor, man, they still don't have, you know, there's nothing being charged. One thing about it in life is that we only get to live one time.
Yeah.
Somebody gets killed, there's no coming back. No coming back. At all. We want that to stop completely. To me, a police officer has every weapon in the book. They got a taser, they got
everything,
a thing to beat you with. I mean, they got cuffs, they got everything in the
mace,
they got everything. And you choose to use the hardest weapon you got and shoot somebody. I mean, you even got a bulletproof press if they got a gun. Still got everything. Not to understand that somebody pulled a gun on somebody. I understand. But with somebody not having any weapon on them and you shooting them or you beating them to death and they not trying to fight back, man, that's, you know, that's brutality.
Yeah, that's, you know, that's bad, man.
That's just what it is. And that's just how I see it. And I just think we need change. There's no doubt about it. We need change. That has
I'm with you, especially still being fairly young, being black, raising kids. It's a cycle that has to be broken. How can we break that cycle? I think we're making those moves forward to do that. And we have some people on board with us that aren't black. So hopefully the consistency of that continues and we start to see some of these laws change, people being more educated, actually implementing more black education into the school systems so others can learn about our plight. And the things that we've had to go through, meeting our ancestors, in order to allow us to have the lives that we're living right now, man. So I definitely appreciate the insight on what's going on with these social issues here in the United States. You know, I like to hear that coming from you, especially, man. You're a soft spoken cat. You don't say much, but I think something like this really hit home for you, especially because you have a family, man. But I definitely commend you on that, and I know you're doing some things to help lead the charge and educating others on what needs to be done in order for this to stop and for us to live comfortably in our homes, in our cars, out in public in the stores, wherever in the park. You know, we're walking on eggshells when it comes to us leaving out of the, not even leaving the front door, but answering the door. You feel what I'm saying? If we got to answer the door, it's like, damn, should I answer the door? What should I do? Should I just unlock it and lay on the floor? What should I do? You know what I'm saying? It's crazy.
You shouldn't have to live with that uncomfortable nerve. And I wouldn't say that I'm soft-spoken about this. It's just that I didn't have I respect LeBron's platform because he uses his platform to the biggest, to me, to the one of the best that anybody can use as an athlete. Yeah. You know, I have a lot of respect for him. You know, it's not just about on the court for him. It's off the court that he's taking full advantage. I just feel like I've had this conversation not on camera with people, but I've had this conversation with people that I think need to have the conversation with.
Yeah.
The people that's important to have the conversation with, I've had it with, you know, and I just, you know, I'm one of them people that just want to, you know, I want to move the needle forward, you know,
for sure.
Like, that's important for us. Like you said, for our kids coming along, you know, I was one that donated to Kaepernick because I felt like that was big. You know, this man risked his career at a point in time, you know, before he's about to be a free agent. He was the first one to do this. And he's risking his career because he sees something bigger than football, which I respect it, you know, and I'm like, man, he's looking at it from a different aspect. And I respect it.
Yeah, that sacrificial lamb, man. And definitely, and I meant, you know, when you soft spoke, you don't never say much. You know, when you talk, obviously people are going to listen. Because knowing you for the past, what, almost 15 years, 16 years or whatever it's been, you don't really say much, man. But when you do, you know, you're making a point and people actually listen. So I definitely commend you on what you're doing, man, what you have done, what you will continue to do. But, man, this is the League Talk Podcast. And part of that, part of what we just talked about is part of our culture, playing baseball, playing football, basketball, whatever major sport it is. So I'm glad we got to address it. But we're going to hop into you, bro. We're going to hop into you and your journey to the league and your successes in the league, playing those 11, 12 years at the major league level and accomplishing a lot. So let's dive into it, man. And I know you played multiple sports. Talk about that first time you stepped on a basketball court, a football field, a baseball field, put on that uniform for an organized team. What sport came first? Was it baseball, football, basketball? What sport did you play first?
So it went in this order. It went baseball first at 5, football second at 9, and organized basketball. My first game I played was in 7th grade. So I start back. When I played Little League baseball, was at a park called Smokey Jasper Little League in the inner city of Houston. If anybody, pretty much at that time, when I was 5 to 14, so I was around about, I started, that was in the years of 87 and 88 till about, 96, something like that, around that time. Most people that played baseball, they knew about this park. It was in the back of Riverwood, and I mean, it was a all-black little league. I mean, it was from 5 to 14. So you had about – we had T-ball back there, junior midget, senior midget, freshman, and sophomore back there. 5, 6, 7 was T-ball. 8, 9 was junior midget. 8 was junior midget. 9 and 10 was senior midget. 11, 12, freshman. 13, 14, sophomore. So at every division, we had about 10 to 12 teams. Something around that area?
All black kids.
All black.
That's crazy.
You ask anybody back there that played baseball, they'll tell you. And I mean some real live competition. Like, it was basically the Negro Leagues back there. You ask anybody in Houston that played baseball, they played back there, they'll tell you. They'll be like, oh, man, like, so much talent back there. Carl Crawford came from back there. Jason Bourgeois came from back there. Dominic Smith, who also played in the minor leagues, came from back there. So we all came from back there, and we had some kids that could play. Also, people that played football came from back there. I mean, we just had all kind of talent back there. Yes, man. And so that got my journey started. And, you know, I played back there from about 5 to 14. So all the way through the freshman year of my high school, and I stopped playing after that. And I started my high school. So I mean, I had a great journey. I enjoyed it, man. It's like one of the best times of my life that I can remember and just reflect back on and looking like, man, that was My father was my coach.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about Pops. How was it playing for Pops, you know, through your through those young years?
We definitely had our run-ins. And you know, me and Carl, probably we came up on the same team together from 9
Yeah.
to 4. You know what I mean? We played on the same team. And, man, me and my daddy had a lot of run-ins, you know. I was talking about it all the time. And of course, he knew what he was talking about. And he always told me he wanted me to have a son. And he helped me be just like me. And he meant it when he said it. And, man, I mean, you know, that father-son run-in is going to happen. And
for sure.
We had our battles. But now we best of friends, man. I call him about anything. We talk all the time. And, you know, I enjoy that time. I don't ever want to do that anymore. I'm more like, hey, I enjoy my time with my pops. He's older now. And I enjoy everything he taught me. He's the first one to put the bat in my hand, you know, like. He was the first one to ever show me playing baseball, and I appreciate that. You know,
That's what's up, man. And you have to definitely salute your pops, because think about it. He was your coach. He could have been super hard on you, and that could have discouraged you to the point to where, man, I'm not playing baseball no more. But the fact that you stuck with it despite those run-ins weren't as bad probably as we look back and think about it. But I've known kids that have played –
They were pretty bad.
They were bad. I look back at kids though, man, back in the day that played for their dads, them boys were tapped out by high school, you know what I'm saying? But obviously you played for 20 plus years, 30 years of baseball. You didn't quit. Even like you said, they were real bad. So
we had some run ins, man. My mother and my brother, they'll tell you. We had some run ins. I was the one that was talking the run ins with him, yeah. But, I actually think it molded me, you know, like, because by him doing that, when I went to college, I had a tough coach in Coach Noble, and he was a hard-nosed coach. But, you know, some of the players didn't like him. But for me, he was like my pops. Like, it was normal to me, you know what I mean? Like, so it was like he molded me for that. Like, and to be honest with you, by him coaching me like that, I respond to that better. My coach that get on me, I respond to that coaching better. Than the pat on your back, coach.
I'm sure. Nah, go ahead. You're more of a tough, hard-nosed type of guy.
Yeah, I like the coach to push me. I like that does me better.
I'm with you, man. I mean, we came up in that. We came up in that type of – in that our generations came up in that type of style of coaching and stuff like that. Now it's tough. You might get them people called on you if you treat a kid a certain type of way. And it's just not what it is now. So definitely extinct. That breed of coaches is pretty much that's few and far in between. So your dad prepped you, man. You said you played in that league from age 5 to 14. You went to high school. Now the dynamic has changed. You don't have a team full of brothers. Now you mixing in, and you might be one of 3, 4, 5 brothers on the squad. How did you adjust to that when you stepped on the high school field? Now you don't have all the homeboys that you grew up with and been with every summer. Y'all done split up. Some guys may have quit playing ball for whatever reasons, chose another sport. You stuck with it, and now you're a minority.
So you are dead on with what you're saying, man. Like, so I don't know. My coach was Coach Hensley, very good coach, man. He welcomed me on. I played my junior and senior year at varsity. Freshman and sophomore, I didn't, because my sophomore year, I almost didn't play because I was so worried about baseball, basketball. I thought I was going to be the next Allen Iverson and all that. You know, I'm dead in the basketball. You can ask anybody I want a chance to. Well, my sophomore year in high school, he told me, you know, I went out late. Like, I went out when district started, basically. And he was like, Mike, I got to put you on the sophomore team. You came out here late. I was like, I respect that. Like, I'm the one that chose to come out late. I was in the gym hooping, you know, doing all that. And he was like, yeah. He's like, I want to move you up, but I can't do that because, you know, that's not respectful to all of the players, which I understood. Yeah. So, you know, but the kids that I played with from at Nimitz, you know, I probably had about 3 or 4 black kids out there. One of my friends named Keith Hodges was out there. There's another kid that also played, but you know, the white kids I played with, they were cool. Some of the Mexican Mexican kids, they were cool, man. Like, we had time. You know, they were loud, you know, have fun. And we would, you know, have fun at the games. We had a good team. And man, I enjoyed it. You know, like it was, I didn't have a bad experience, you know, but with them, I just played baseball with them.
Yeah.
I hung out with everybody I played basketball and football with after I left the baseball game or after for I left sure. practice. I was
yeah. all
back to where I was, you know what I mean, comfortable.
Your comfort zone. You was comfortable.
In my comfort zone. You know, so I also, you know, going back, I played football from 9 years old as well. So I was always, you know, that's another dominantly African-American sport. But where I played at was mixed too. You know, it was not black, but it was whites too. So, you know, we had it kind of balanced where I played Little League football there. But baseball and basketball?
All black.
You know, by. But basketball was probably my favorite coming up at that time. You know?
Yeah, that's crazy.
Baseball, though, that's where baseball was the one that took over after my junior year. My senior year, I kind of understood that.
Some things up.
Well, after my junior year, I made first team audition, which I made it in basketball too, though. So
yeah, I made it tough, huh? Yeah, like I'm doing like something.
You're starting to have to make a decision, like which one am I gonna do? And I want to recall I started getting a couple letters. Like I wasn't a highly recruited baseball player out of high school, so senior year coming in, I'm in basketball, but my mind is a little bit on baseball at the time. At the same time, you know, I go through my basketball season. I have a pretty good season, and we lose in the first round of the playoffs. Bam! Soon as we lose the next day,
oh.
I'm not waiting. I had a couple letters, you know. I wasn't waiting to nothing. So I go through my senior season, have a good senior baseball season. We end up making it to like the second or third round in the playoffs. We end up losing to Clear Lake High School, I remember. But I had a pretty good game, pretty good playoff. And I signed with Galveston Junior College in the middle of the season. He was one of the – I had Galveston Junior College and Sam Houston State come out and recruit me. Sam Houston State, they wasn't real interested in me. Galveston, hey, he was all in. He was like, hey, I want you to come to college. You're going to lead off. You're going to play center field. So – this is like probably the craziest time of my baseball career up to this point for me because I have a lot of decisions to make. So after my senior season, which, you know, what was season? April, May, around that time?
Yeah, like May. We're about to get out of school around May.
To get out of school. It starts to end. So, kid, you know Wardell Starling.
Yeah, I know Wardy.
His father, rest in peace, his dad passed away.
I didn't know that, man. I didn't know that. RIP, man.
Good man. Good man. Definitely. Very good man. So one day I'm at the house. He asked me, he said, Mike, do you want to play AAU baseball with us? I was like, yeah, what team? He was like, the Houston Bombers. I was like, yeah, why not? Should I ain't do it? You know what I mean? Like, I guess I play. So this is the only time I play AAU baseball. I haven't played all the way up. I played for my summer team just a little bit.
Yeah.
I played before this. So I go out there and I'm playing. I'm doing my thing. Next thing you know, the head coach that's at U of H now comes to me and tells me, hey, we want to offer you a scholarship. I'm like, I laughed at him, Shane. I was like, nah, man.
No.
I'm playing, man. You ain't gonna offer me. He's like, no, I'm dead serious. We'll offer you a scholarship. I'm like, you serious? Yeah, I want you to be the head coach next week. I'm like, nah. I don't know what to do, Shane. I'm like, man, what should I do? You know, like, so I laughed at him, and it wasn't in a bad way. I just didn't believe that, you know, they was going to offer me a scholarship, you know?
Yeah.
I'm like, man, you really going to offer me a scholarship? He's like, yeah, you know? And so what happened was the next week I ended up meeting the coach. You know, he talked to me about coming to play, told me that they wanted me to come there. But, you know, as you know, back then they had a draft to follow. So I also got drafted by Astros out of high school. So it was a big decision for me to make because I got drafted in the 19th round. They wanted me to go to junior college to play for a year. And then we go see what's going to happen from there, you know. And so for me, I didn't know which one I wanted to do, to be honest with you. I was like, man, what should I do? You know, and I asked my dad, and my dad was like, I want you to make the decision. It's going to be one of your biggest decisions you make, so I want you to make it. You know, it's on you. I'm like,
Yeah.
It's a real life decision, you know?
Hell yeah.
I'm like, I don't know which one to do. But lo and behold, I end up going to U of H. So that means they lose the draft rights to me as a baseball player. The Astros lose the draft rights, and I end up going to U of H, and I start my career from there, you know? And I think it was the right decision for me, you know? And I got to play against some good competition. I think that that molded me as I went into the minor leagues as time went on. But I got to play good competition. I got to play against you at LSU.
Yeah.
Yep. You know, so it was good for me because I was coming out of high school and I didn't play a lot of baseball up until that time. You know, I only played at my high school pretty much. And then when I went to college, I learned, you know, a whole nother realm of baseball, playing against USC, LSU, Rice, Texas. You know, these are good competition for me, you know, and it measured me real good. But I held my own. I'm a competitor, so, you know.
For sure. Like
feet, you know, they're just in my blood. So my freshman year was – I ended up making freshman All-American, and I made second team All-Conference. So I was happy with that, but I wanted to be better than that. And my sophomore year, I think I took off a little bit more. You know, I think I made most of my noise my sophomore year, which put me in a good space for my junior year. You know, in college, you have to stay 3 years, and then you can get drafted unless you're drafted as a sophomore at 21. Well, I had to stay 3 years. I was only 20 still.
You was young.
Yeah, I was still young. But when I got to my junior year, I was projected to go pretty high in, like, the first and second round. But I hurt my hamate bone. I broke my handmade bone, and my father was trying to tell me and a young kid was trying to tell Mike, sit out, relax, don't rush back. I'm hard-headed. I try to hit back in 2 weeks. I'm like, man, I'm ready. You know? Like, you showed him enough. I'm like, no, I got to show him again, you know, like I got hurt. We just talked about this like a month ago. I was like, man, you were right, Daddy. You know, I should have listened, you know, but you know, when you're 19, you think
yeah, you know. Yeah. You know it all already.
I ain't know nothing, you know?
Yeah, you knew it all in Little League when he was coaching you. You thought you knew it all. So don't tell me now. I'm at the house. I'm 19, 20 years old. I'm good. I know it already. I know what I'm doing. Don't tell me nothing.
Don't know nothing, man. Went behind the ears. Don't know nothing, Shane. I'm like, man. But, you know, it also taught me to kind of wait. If you have an injury, I think that's big with sports sometimes. You know how it is, man.
Yeah.
Out there trying to prove, but you're not ready to play yet, you know. And I wasn't ready to play. I struggled when I came back. I mean, I was hitting like 110, man.
Yeah, you can't even grip the bat with that hamate bone. It's hard to grip the bat.
I was a bottom hand too, and I'm a bottom hand hitter mostly. I can't grip it, but I was still trying, you know.
Yeah.
My coach came to me after like a week of playing, a week and a half. He's like, hey, look. I don't want you to mess up your hand, number one. Sit out, make sure it's right, and then you can come back and play. I was like, all right, coach. So I waited about 4 more weeks, and I came back probably the end of the right before the conference tournament. You know, we were still in conference play, but I still came back. I had a couple games. Man, but I was, you know, since I hadn't played in a while, I wasn't seeing
them
over, striking out. I mean, I ain't doing nothing, but all of a sudden, I catch my rhythm. So I end up hitting around about 3:30. I came up from like 115 to 3:30. I caught five. But I end up getting drafted in the fourth round by the Phillies, which at that time, Shane, to me, was one of the best organizations I could have went to.
Oh, I can agree with you on that, man. And before we hop into the Philly days and going through the minor leagues, you shared something with me going back to high school, you know, you making it through. Basketball was the sport you thought you was going to be the next AI. You were still playing football. You started getting a little attention from baseball. I'm thinking that's what helped you make the decision of, you know what, I'm going to put a little bit more of my time and attention into the game of baseball. Then, you know, things took off your senior year. You got drafted. That summer you played with Wardell. They showed you a different brand of baseball, kind of prepared you for college. Now, getting drafted by the Astros hometown team, 17 years old. You probably hadn't been out of Houston or many places as a youngster, right? I was in that same boat you know, drafted at 17, the same, not the 19th round, I was the 45th round by the Dodgers, but I had a similar situation where I signed with a JUCO, then LSU called, kind of like U of H came for you. And the rest was history. I went to LSU instead of going to JUCO, signing a contract. So you did that, man. It says a lot about you. You think, you know, you needed to mature mentally and play more baseball before you took on the challenges of being a professional. It was good that you understood that. You had that family dynamic, especially from pops, to help you make those decisions as well, or put you in place to make the right decisions. So let's jump into the Phillies. Like you said, great organization. I got to spend a little time with them in 08. Unfortunately, my career ended with them kind of early, but you get drafted in the fourth round, you decide to sign. I think that's when I ran into you again after facing you in 2001 at LSU. Ran into you, I think, in Instructional League in 2003, and we kind of reconnected there. But tell me about that feeling, man, getting that call in the fourth round, drafted by the Phillies, and was it a no-brainer to sign, or was it still some things you had to think about before you made that decision?
Well, like I said, I'm a competitor, man. So, actually, when I got the call from the Phillies, you can ask my pops, I was upset.
It was the fourth round, huh?
Yeah, I should have been the first round. That's three rounds too late, man.
Yeah.
I remember the night before, I couldn't sleep. I'm hot, man. He'll tell you, but that's my competitive nature, man. Like, I'm a competitor at heart, you know. So, I end up getting drafted by the Phillies, but I end up signing. I knew, me going back my senior year, I wasn't going to have much leverage, you know. And I just felt like it was time to go, you know. It was time for me to prove my point, you know. I got drafted in the fourth round. It wasn't like I got drafted low, you know. End up signing close to $300,000 at the time. You know, it was like, man, look, it's time to make tomorrow. If you're gonna do it, let's try to do it now. And
yeah.
Sean, you said something that's very interesting to me that I deal with kids all the time, and I wanted to ask you about. I'm gonna reverse the role on this.
Oh, it's all good. That's all we hear, baby. It's the League Talk podcast.
You know, you gotta get a podcast all type of different. You know,
for sure.
You know what I mean?
I'm with you.
I don't know what's really going on because
I'm with you.
Came from an era where it was a little different, so I want to ask you because we had a similar situation. You know. Do you recommend a kid going out of high school if they get drafted high enough, or do you recommend him going out of college? Which one do you think fares better?
Man, that's tough. Obviously, if they're throwing some cheese at you, it should be an easy decision. But for me, I think it depends on your experience and your knowledge of the game, number one. And second, how do you handle certain situations? Because
yes,
you're growing up in the house, you're in the crib with your parents or your mom, your dad, whoever it may be, and they're taking you through each step of the way. Now, if you sign a pro contract, you a grown man.
Talk to
him, that situation becomes different. Now you're responsible for certain things. You're not either early or you're late, bro. You're never on time. And there's certain things you got to be able to work through that. You can't call mom or dad or whoever to help you through it. So educating yourself. This has been the theme of my week, Mike, talking to these kids that I've been training. Man, everybody always thinking about the physical. Nobody takes the time to focus on the mental. Everything is physical. So mentally, if you prepare and know how to make adjustments from that sense and not a robot, and you just going to play baseball, and if something goes wrong outside that box, you don't know how to handle it, of course, go to college. Because for me, that helped big time mentally. I knew nothing about baseball. Mike, bro, I told somebody the other day, my glove when I went to LSU, dog, it was one of them Ken Griffey, you know, them Walmart gloves you buy at a Walmart that used to have them autographs in the palm.
You was using that?
That's what I had when I went to college, bro.
Hey, I use the same gloves since I was like, that's what kids don't know, man. Like, Shane, we're getting a little bit off subject, but it's still the same.
It's all good. It's all good.
I feel like, you know, some of this stuff with AAU, I'm like, bro, I wasn't doing nothing. You was very successful in Major League Baseball. And I'm looking at some of this stuff and I'm like,
yeah,
like, I didn't know none of this stuff. I was just playing baseball. I had the same gloves since I was 11 years old. My daddy bought me a nice glove. A real, He spent some hard earned money. He was like, hey, you gonna have this glove for a while, so you better keep it. I used it all the way through until I got to college, and Wilson came to us and was like, you know, TPX, you go to a nice college, they're gonna come to you.
Of course.
Oh, you gotta get your new glove. Okay, all right. But some of this stuff, like I asked you that because I had a friend that was like that, and you know, they were asking me, what should I do? You know, what should I do with my son? I said, man, it depends on the person. I can't tell you what to do. You know your son the best. You know, is he ready to be a grown man? That's what he's gonna get treated like if he's going to football.
Yeah.
You know, I'm telling you, it's a big decision. So some kids might be able to do it. Depends on the household. Like you said, you got somebody from the hood, they throw a $2 million. All right, he gotta go.
He gotta go. Man? Gotta take care of the family.
Different for him.
And it depends, like you said, the situation. And it's more so mentally, it becomes a mental thing at that point, as opposed to being that physical, whatever physical talent you have. So for me, like I said, man, I'm sure for you, you needed to mature more, play more baseball. That's why you went to college. For me, I needed to mature more and learn the game from the mental side, because like you said, we just went out there and played ball. Dog, I had a Ken Griffey autographed glove, $40 at Walmart, you know what I'm saying? If I take it to my daddy crib right now, my little freshman picture or my glove, I got that glove on, bro. I got it on. Imagine I would have walked onto a professional facility with that thing.
They'd have clowned you the whole time, man.
That's what I'm saying.
But you know, we hear these stories all the time from kids that have played football, and we know, and we like, you know, I know some of these kids probably think that I'm crazy, but I preach to them all the time. Like, man, hey, let your kid be a kid, man. I really want to talk about this to you because I feel like sometimes kids are not kids. They're so worried about trying to be a professional at 9 years old. Like, man, you're 9. Exactly. Why are you worried about being a professional right now? I mean, that's good to be – that's your goal. Like, I have no problem with that. Like, yeah, you want to be good, but also enjoy being a kid, man.
Yeah.
Enjoy your kid. Go play with your friends, man. Go play the video games. Go outside and play tag, man. Go, go down the street and play basketball sometime. You know, y'all play hide and go seek. All of it. No,
do that.
Don't be a kid. I think that you put so much emphasis. I mean, you're going to all these practices and all these
showcases.
What are you doing? You ain't even, hey, what they teaching you right now, they teach you that dude that's 21 years old, man. So
of guess course.
What? You got time, you know? I see it so much, and I'm like, man, I ain't gonna lie to you, I couldn't play that much baseball from 8.
Nah, man, and they only specializing in baseball. It's like, man, play something else, do something else.
Something else, man. I mean, I think some of the kids think that I'm just telling them just to say it, but I'll be serious. I'm like, man, I wouldn't play that much baseball at 9, 10 years old. There's no way I've been playing 80 games at 9 years old.
No chance. No chance.
When the first time you played 80 games? I
don't even think I played 80 games in if you count the fall and all of that. I didn't even play 80 games. The most we played was 74.
But an 18-year-old ain't playing 80 games. The first time I played 80 games, I was in pro ball. So you telling me a 9-year-old can handle his body can handle that?
Nah, bro. And they playing 3-4 games in a day sometimes. That's right there, that's bizarre. I can't get down with that. And
I want to start a team. I've been thinking about starting a team in Houston, but my thing is I'm gonna try to keep the number of games down if I do.
Yeah.
That. I mean, I don't mind them playing 40 to 50. I know that if you win, you're gonna play a little bit more.
But man, yeah, pick your poison.
Like I mean, you was a pitcher, man, and I try to stress to these young kids, Shane, that take care of your arm, man. Don't be over out there overthrowing. I had a kid one day. Kid can play. He went deep. And that same game, he's playing. He's pitching, right? He pitched about – he probably threw about 30, 40 pitches. So the next day, I'm talking to his daddy. We leaving. We lost. Our team lost. So his son comes up to him. He's like, Dad, I got the wrong glove. He's like, what you – he said, I'm about to pitch. I noticed. I know he pitched the day before.
Yeah.
He's up. So I'm like, asked that. I said, man, watch his arm, you know? You know, he's like, oh, no, I'm watching. Make sure he don't throw no more than 60 pitches. I said, 60? I mean, you count the ones yesterday, too? You know? Because he threw yesterday, you know? He's like, yeah, I know. And I said, if I was you, I'd let him throw one in it. That's it. Because, you know, if the kid got a chance, you know, you can kind of see when kids have some talent. Yeah. They have a chance to play. He got a chance, Shane. He can play. He can hit. He got some power. But why wear his arm out at 9, 10 years old? You know, some coaches don't know that. Some coaches don't care.
They don't. They be trying to win them rings, man. It's all about winning a ring and not developing a kid. And that's why if you were to start your organization, it would be great because you walk that walk. Yes. You know, your dad, from your dad to your high school coach to U of H to pro ball, which we're going to jump into in a second, the development. You know how to develop a player. Most guys go out there and they're just trying to win championships. You have a few that look to develop kids, but you're talking about the arm care and just throwing too much. They go out there to win. They're rolling with their horses. Not thinking about that kid 5, 6, 10 years from now. It's all about right now, which is a shame because you're looking at that. Nobody's going to remember what you won, like you said, 9 years old. Nobody's going to remember that ring. Nobody's going to remember that. You know, let's see how many kids you can get to a level to where they know how to do things on their own. They know how to make adjustments on their own. You know, they know how to figure out certain things on their own. That's why I say if you were to start your team, that would be something that kids don't get, man. And it's a process, bro. It don't happen overnight for you. Exactly. You was mad you got drafted in the fourth round because you thought you should have went first round, right? But you was on a fast track to the big leagues. You was in the big leagues less than 3 years after you signed. Mm-hmm. So talk about that because you went, you know, playing with your boys from 5 to 14, to high school, to college. You're drafted. You went from U of H. Now you're in the Phillies organization, great organization, but them damn minor league facilities aren't all that good. And you just left U of H. So tell me, tell me what happened when you first stepped foot in that damn clubhouse in Clearwater. What was going through your head?
That wasn't my first clubhouse. No. The first clubhouse I ever went to.
Batavia.
Oh, Shane. Oh, my goodness. Shane, I walk in that clubhouse, and I'm like, what is this, man? Like, I just came from U of A, you know what I'm saying? I'm on a flight in a nice hotel, and we go from staying. Oh, my goodness. And like you said, you couldn't have said it better, man. I was like, oh, my goodness, man. Hey, I vowed one thing when I got there, that I will never – play another season in this city. I would never, ever play another. And I got off to a slow start because I had been sitting down for a while.
Yeah.
I was like, hey, I'm going to keep working. It was nothing to do there. I met Javon Moran. Yeah. Met him linked up there. He's a very good player, man. And,
Auburn. I played against him in college, too.
Yes, sir. And so he was like, man, Mike, you come stay with me. You know, I was like, where you stay at? You know, first of all, I was staying there. They didn't have no internet service. You know, internet was hard to get back then.
Oh, yeah.
I was just sitting there. I'm like, oh, man, so I went with him. And I told the people, like, I'm going to stay with him. So I go over there with him. You know, we just get to know each other. And he goes to the next room, and I hear the Madden cut off. You know, I love Madden back then.
Yeah.
Because I was like, what you playing? He was like, I'm playing Madden. I was like, you got another controller? He was like, yeah. I said, oh, that's all I need. You know what
that's
I mean?
It.
And that got me through Batavia, man. Because, man, you know how that short season was. It was.
Oh, yeah. Nothing. I was in Williamsport, so, you know.
Hey, I think I took Williamsport off of Batavia, though, man. I don't know. Batavia.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
It was not what it was. So, but that was my first introduction to pro ball. So, you know, with that happening, I go to Batavia, I come home after that short season, and, you know, they let you know they expected us to go to low A the next year. So I get the spring training, and so this is my first offseason. You know,
yeah.
Man, people don't understand it. Probably you're learning all types of stuff. You're learning how to work out on your own. You're learning when to start to work out, when to start throwing. I got to learn all this stuff, you know, because I was a person that, like, I wanted to be prepared when I went in.
So, yeah,
man, in the offseason, Shane, I'm lifting weights, running, and doing all this. I'm trying to follow the program first. Remember that big old book?
Oh, yeah, big old notebook full of stuff. Book,
you know what I mean? I'm looking at all the stuff to do, and I'm throwing. But, Shane, I'm throwing, like, way too much in the offseason. I don't know how to time this stuff yet, you know?
Yeah.
I'm really throwing. I'm launching the ball, like, from outfield all the way to center field, like hard as I could to get my arm in shape. So I strained like a little tendon in my elbow because I've been throwing too much. You know, I'm like, oh man, so I get to spring training and it's kind of hurting me. You know, I'm throwing, but I can throw through it, but it's hurting me.
Yeah.
So send me out for a little bit throwing wise. I was still hitting and doing everything. And one of the form director, one of those came up to me and was like, minor league coordinator came to me. He was like, hey, last week, he was like, if you can't throw the ball 60 feet, you're going to have to stay in.
Extended.
Extended. Hey, man, give me that ball.
I saw that locker. I saw that clubhouse over there.
This high son is extended. I heard too much about this. So give me that ball. Hey, my ball was turning to throw it too. Oh! I threw 60 feet. And he was like, okay, you should be fine. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They eased me back into it, but that year I had one of my best years in pro ball in the minor leagues. I won the minor league player of the year. I was MVP of the team. I hit around 315, had a good on base percentage. I worked on my angles in the outfield a lot. I used to shoot two groups a day. And now I really learned how to play center field good. Now, me and Javon Moran used to switch playing center field and right field each series because we had two center fielders.
Yeah.
By the end of that year, they ended up trading him to the Reds. And so center field was mine at that point, you know. But we had a lot of center fielders in our organization.
Yeah, I know, man.
Me, Javon Moran, Chris Roberson, Marlon Byrd, Shane Victorino. They all were in the organization at the same time.
That's crazy.
Yeah, you know, so it was a, you know, I knew that, but, you know, you also got to know it's 30 other teams out there, 29 other teams looking at you, you know, every day, you know, so. I don't really care about it. I just, you know, I'm going to go out there and compete. And from low A, I had a very good year. So they skipped me up to double A the next year.
This 2005, and that's when we run into each other again because I'm in double A with the Pirates.
Yep. You and Altoona.
Altoona,
right?
Yeah. Me and Rajay, man. Vic Butler was there for a while. I'm going to tell you this. That year, man, I'm going to tell you this, and I know we ended up connecting. You know, that whole year was a special year, dog, whether it was me, you, CJ, Charlton Jemison, who I had on the show a couple weeks back. The first time I saw somebody tag from second and score was you. That was that year.
And
my boy, Rajay Davis, because he was lollygagging out there in center field.
Shout out to Rajay, man. He had a wonderful career in the big leagues, man.
Yeah,
shout
man. That's our boy. I had him on the show, too. He was my first guest, man, Rajay. Rajay did a lot of things, bro, overcame a lot. But saw you tag. The first person I ever seen tag from second base and score was you in 05. And even though we played against y'all, I always appreciated you and Roby, man. The way y'all played the outfield, bro. Y'all were some aggressive dudes out there. Whether he was in center or right, he was in center or right, vice versa. The way y'all played the game, man, y'all was aggressive out there but under control. So I always paid attention to how y'all did y'all think defensively, man. But that year was special, man. I'm going to let you speak on 05 when you got up to double A and was playing in Reading.
So 05 was a very good learning experience for me because, as you know, when you get to double A, that's where all the talent is, especially back then. Like, you're going to fight face a lot of more hard throwers, people that know what they're doing with the ball a little bit on the pitcher's mound. Like you said, pitchers expect you to be able to position yourself in the outfield to be able to know, like, okay, hey, we want you to cover this ground, this dude is hitting. You're starting to learn how to play in the big leagues a little bit. You know, it's starting to, you know, this what they from this level on have a chance to play in the big leagues, basically.
For sure.
And, you know, Shane, I end up starting out slowing. I as I look at it, man, I'm a slow starter sometimes, you know. Yeah. I just don't start out well all the time. I can prepare all day long. And plus it was cold up there, you know.
Yeah, it was real cold out there.
But I never used it as like, oh, I'm starting. I just started out slow. But I ended up picking it up real good, you know, like real good. I remember that second month I started like catching fire. I ended up making the Eastern League All-Star team, which is big for me. So that year, by the end of that year, man, I ended up being top five in run score, top five in hits, top five in stolen bases, and I don't know if they had a defensive team. But I remember having a lot of assists that year too.
Yeah, so, like I said, you and Roby, y'all were doing some damage out there. Nobody could run on y'all.
Better year than me that year. He had an unbelievable year that year. I remember. But we played neck and neck off each other, man. And it was a great learning experience. We would switch center field and right field all the time. And man, we just learned off each other. And I got to play against like you, Rajay, Big Butler, man. Shout out to Big Butler too.
Yeah.
Hey. Special talent to me. He could hit.
Yeah, that cat should have made it to the big leagues, man. He should have got some time.
No doubt about it, you know. And I felt that, and I watched him. He was a left-handed hitter, so I watched him. And when we played y'all, you know, facing you, you know, we always had our battles.
For sure.
Always good, though, you know what I mean? Like, we could always talk about that afterwards, and it was always good. But I'll tell you another thing that was special to me, which made that year – probably one of them.
Oh, I already know where you're going. I know where you're going.
We got to go to the fall league.
We got to go to the fall league.
Oh, man. You know, that's like I don't know how it is now, but back then you wanted to go to the fall league to have that experience. So, you know, you're going to play 6 days a week and you're going to have Sunday out. You know? And we had, you know, me, you, Charlton Jemison down there. We all linked up and had a good time. Corey Smith. You know, so.
Chris Young. Another H-Town cat.
Yep, Chris Young. We had a great time, man. And y'all, look, on this episode, we talk about this because not many people know about this, but only me and him know about this.
Put it out there. I'm ready for that.
One night, you know, me and Shane decide to go out. You know, you're young. You know, you want to go, you know. And I was way in surprise at the time, you know.
Yeah.
I don't even know what club we was at, man.
I don't remember either.
I don't remember where we was at. So me and Shane go out, y'all. And Shane, he sees one of the best boxers of all time walk across us. So he's walking crazy. I don't know if you remember.
Yeah, I remember.
I don't know what he was.
I remember. Dog, exactly. Exactly.
Yeah, I was like, dang. And Shane was like, it was Mike Tyson, y'all. So Shane goes out, Mike! And he finally got his attention. But Mike gave Shane his look, y'all. Hey, I remember his look to this day. He looked at Shane, turned and looked at him. Like, what's wrong with you calling my name like that? I say, Shane! Hey, man, I don't know what we're going to do about this, man. I can't help you with Mike, man. Hey, Mike, baby. What are we going to do?
I wouldn't have had no baseball career after that night.
I said, that's Mike Tyson, man. I know Mike Tyson probably don't even notice. He probably looking like, what they talking, man? This actually happened. He just don't remember it. And he just didn't know who we were at the time. But it was so funny, man. We laughed about that all night. And the next day, hey, I never forgot about that, man.
We still laugh. Every year you hit me up. Hey, man, I just had a conversation with somebody about that time you and Mike Tyson in the club in Arizona. So every year since 2005, bro, it's been a conversation at some point in time. You hit me up with some stuff.
Hey, man, that was epic, man. We didn't expect it. We didn't think that was going to happen. It happened out of nowhere.
It was. I ain't never been so scared in my life. When that dude turned and looked at me, bro, I ain't never been so scared in my life when that happened, bro.
And luckily, he just went on about his business, man.
Yeah.
I stood there. I was watching, you know. I was like, hey, Mike, we can't do that, baby. We can't do that, man. He cool, man.
Nobody was going to stop him. That's the thing. If you'd have decided to charge me like a bull, nobody was going to stop him. Nobody could have stopped him. You know what I'm saying?
I would have tried to get him off me if I could, man, but I probably would have to take a couple
we would have been hurting, bro. We would have to hope that insurance would have been good enough to take care of us because we would have been done, bro. I'm sorry, bro. But
– oh, well, I don't know. You really wanted Mike Tyson's attention that night, man.
That was Mike, bro. That was Iron Mike, bro. So, you know, at least give me a little dab or something.
I mean, it was crazy, man.
That was probably one of the craziest nights we had in Arizona, man. That was a fun fall. We can't dive into too many specifics, but that was a fun fall, man. And that set you up. That set you up. You got put on the 40-man that year.
Indeed.
With the Phillies for the first time, and then you go out there, you go back to AA, you do your thing still, and then you get that call up, July of that year?
When I went back to AA because I felt like, you know, I had a good enough year to go, you know, to move up. I had to come to grips with myself that, like, hey, look, this is where they want you to go. I was mad for real, you know, and I took my time and had to calm down. I had got sent down for big league camp, which I wasn't mad about that part. I already knew I wasn't going to make the team. I had number 76 on my back. So I knew
yeah, that ain't happening.
I knew what time it is.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, you know, I knew what time it is. But you know, it happened, you know. And when I went down, I had to get myself together. And, like, that's what you – like, what we were talking about, that's why I asked about, like, you know, where you think somebody should go. At this time, I'm 23, you know.
Yeah.
But I'm mature enough now to where, like, you know, I'm mad, but I know, like, man, look.
You can handle that.
I mean, like, get past this. It is what it is. You know, go back to Double A, do what you need to do, and then you're going to move up. You know, you better do what you need to do. So, like you said, I ended up going back to Double A, moving through, playing pretty good the first 2 or 3 months, and what happened was they moved me up to Triple A. Probably, I want to say I made the All-Star. No, you know what happened? It was right around the All-Star break for Double A.
Yeah.
I made the All-Star team, but I didn't go because I ended up going to Triple
A. I remember that because I was back in Double A. I made the All-Star team that year. You wasn't there.
Mm-hmm. And I'm going to tell you what was crazy about this year, man, is that I go to Triple A and Double A, I'm hitting around about 270, 280. Around that area, but I'm playing very good defensive wise, all of it. You know, I'm doing pretty good. Man, I get the Triple A, Shane, and all of a sudden I just catch fire. I don't know what it is. I don't know if it's because I'm about to be
a Canadian. That Canadian water. You was in Canada, probably, huh?
No. I'm in Scranton.
Oh, that's right. They hadn't moved yet. That's right.
Hadn't moved, you know.
Right.
And I just catch fire. I'm hitting around 330. You know what I mean? Like for the whole month, I'm catching fire. I'm catching everything. I'm hitting a couple home runs, doubles, I'm everything.
Doing it all.
So I get a call. You know, I'm after a day game. My coach, my manager Russell, he actually was with the Pirates for a while.
Yeah, he was a big league manager with the Pirates for a little bit too.
He was a Triple A manager at that time.
John Russell, I think his name.
Yeah. And he called me over there and he was like, he said, I got some information for you. I was like, what's going on? He said, you're gonna go to the and I had all my stuff was in a hotel at the time. I left it all there. I didn't go get nothing. I just went. I just went straight to Philadelphia. Man. I call my mom and them now, man. Mama, I'm going to play it. What? I just got called up. They excited. So I get there and I get there in like the fifth inning. You know, I'm trying to drive there, get there, but it's late. So I get there, they give me my jersey. I'm wearing number 9 at this time.
Yeah.
And get my jersey on and we're playing the Marlins. So I get there and it's about the fifth inning. So I'm sitting on the bench. I, you know, introduce me to everybody. Hello, how you doing? You know, I sit on the bench, just watch the game. So by the eighth inning, they come and get me. They was like, hey, Mike, get your helmet. What's up? What you mean?
What?
you're hitting for the pitcher. For real? I bought a shot. I put the helmet on. I went to hit. But I wasn't nervous. I think I wasn't nervous because we had played a game earlier that day. And I had my energy was gone. Like, I'm just going off adrenaline by the
plus, you drove. You hightailed it to the game. You hightailed it to Philly.
Yeah, it was a 2-hour drive, and I get there, and when I get in the batter's box, I feel so relaxed. Boy. And one thing I noticed when I got to the game, when I got on the field, I'm like, man, these lights are bright.
Oh yeah,
and like that's the first thing that came to my mind. Like, golly, they light this in Triple A and Double A, man. it seems dark on the field. Now I look, I'm like, God. And Shane, my first at bat, I never forget. I got to like a 2-1 count on him, threw me a cutter, and I just missed it. Shane. I mean, I popped it up to right field. I mean, bah! I get it, and I hit it straight up to right field. But I know I just missed the ball.
Yeah.
I run it out, and I come in the dugout, and Chase Utley was like, ooh, Mike, you just missed that one, didn't you? I said, man, I just missed the chase. But, you know, so the game's over with, you know, and I don't know all the rules of everything. So, I'm going – I get take a shower, get through, go to my room. I'm like, man, I'm still up here, man. Are they gonna keep me on the team? What was going on? You know, the manager told me, like, man, you're probably gonna come back the next day, but just in case. So the next day we got another game, right? You know, play another game. I don't get to play in this game. Play another game.
Nobody still hadn't told me nothing, you know. I go buy a whole outfit in the morning because I ain't want to be not prepared to get on the plane if I happen to have to get on the plane, you know.
Yeah.
Buy a whole outfit. Damn, okay. Go buy it and fill out, find some place to go buy it. Bam. So we get to the field, you know, play the game, and then I take a shower and dress. I'm sitting at the table, Ron Howard. So I'm with Ron. Ron, I don't know, Mike. Nobody said nothing to you. Hey, he pumping my head up, Shane. that's what I'm talking about. I'm eating. I'm like one of the last ones. I guess so, you know. Lo and behold, Ruben Amar Jr., you're coming in. Michael, can you come to the office real quick? You tell them, like, all right, you know, they're going to send you back down. You know, we don't want you sitting on the bench. You know, we want you to keep the team to do what you're doing. So, mm-hmm. So I go back to AAA. And so this is, like I said, I had an interesting minor league kind of turn on me because I get back to AAA, but I get choose to go to Team USA.
I remember that. I remember.
If you go to Team USA, though, you can't be in the big leagues. It got to be one or the other, right?
Got to be in the minors.
I go to Team USA. Go to Team USA. We're meeting in, who is in Miami. We're going to Cuba. So we're playing down there for a few warm-up games, getting in shape, you know. Down there, one of the Phillies dudes come down there with me. Lo and behold, Shane, a week into it. He said, hey, be prepared. You might be going back up. What you mean?
Yeah.
You might be getting called back up because something happened. I think they traded somebody and you might be getting called back up. So, all right. So I don't want nothing to happen the first day. He comes to me the next day. He's like, hey, just telling you to be ready. I guess they was calling him and telling him to.
Yeah, keep it on your mind.
Lo and behold, call my room. Hey, pack your stuff. You're going to Philadelphia. You're going to Chicago. They was in Chicago playing. Like, all right, cool. So I pack my stuff. Pack all my stuff. So I get to Chicago. It's a night game, 7 o'clock. You know, there's not a lot of night games at Wrigley.
Yeah.
You know, ain't more day games. So it's a night game this night, right? So I get to Chicago, get in the cab, go to Wrigley. The cab can't pull up on the street where you get out on Wrigley, right? He has to go all the way around. They done blocked it all because of the game. They don't want people to go. I got 3 bags, Shane, that I'm carrying down this long road trying to get. So the game has ended. The game is – I don't get there in time enough for the game. The game –
come on.
Game over. You know how many people be in Wrigley, man.
I know. On the street.
With 3 bags in my hand just trying to And Frank Copenhagen, he was the traveling secretary at the time with the Phillies. He finally – he was like, Michael, he get me – help me out, get down there. I'm like, oh man, thank you, man. I mean, these bags are heavy, man. I got
bags,
all this stuff. And we get down there. You know how you go down, you know, you go in the Philly thing, I mean, into the entrance way, and you go upstairs to go to the clubhouse.
To the clubhouse. It's old, too, so you take the stairs.
I'm walking through all these people, and I get there, and I'm dead tired, Shane. I get there. Oh, goodness, I'm tired. Man, I get there. I put my bags down. He was like, Mike, Charlie want to see you. Charlie Emanuel was the manager at the time. Like, he want to see you. I was like, okay, cool. So I walk in there. And he was like, first thing he say to me, you want the good news or the bad news? You know how it is. This time in my career, I'm like, give me the bad news. The bad news is we traded for somebody in there while you was in there. You got to go back. We're sending you back down. He said, the good news is you get 7 days of big league service, 7 days of, you know, I mean, time. So, I you know, they worked that out to where, like, I could get that, right?
Yeah.
He said, I get 7 days pay. All right, cool. You know, I mean, I can't do nothing about it. I'm mad, though, at the time. I'm, you know, I'm going to be up there. But actually, it was good for me. I go down there, and I go back. So I'm with Team USA now. You know, we're going to Cuba. We playing for the trials, I think, of the Olympics. So we playing – play some good competition. All type of countries are down here. Man, we get to Cuba, man, they got to stand in this hotel that's like, man, it was terrible. You know, I mean, little bitty cots, everybody, we was like, it was bad.
Looking rough.
Man, it was looking rough, Shane. So what happened was the USA people, they went and talked to the people and they were like, nah, we can't have them staying here. So they finally got us set up in a nice hotel, one of their best hotels, very good hotel, you know. We stand in there. We had good security. We eat 3 times a day. And we down there to play. So we down there for about 2 good weeks. You know, I'm hitting leadoff, playing center, you know. So I get down there, and I told you, I don't know what it is about me. I start off slow. I mean, I'm hitting, I'm probably one for my first 11, 12. You know, you ain't got that many games down there. They move me out the leadoff spot, right? You know what I mean? I'm hitting nine. I'm like, man, you know, but for some reason, you know, we're doing good, but we lose one game. You know, we lose a game and we can't lose no more after that, you know. So we keep winning, and we're playing Cuba in the championship game. So we made it to the championship game against Cuba. We get there and we know this is a big game. I think we had a day off or something. We know this is a big game.
Playing Cuba in Cuba.
In Cuba. So we get to the game, you know, we're warming up, and they were like, man, this game is going to be stupid packed. And so we get to the game, and we're about to start the game, and it's probably like maybe 5,000 people there, 7,000. We're like, man, it's not going to be, it's not packed at all. Beginning of the game, after the first inning, Shane, no lie, all they buses that they get for their people to pull up, it pulls up.
Yeah.
And I mean, people come running in the stands, filling the stands up like just a herd of people just everywhere. And you look around by the beginning of the second inning, and I mean, it's no room to sit nowhere. They all there. And I'm like, damn, like 30,000 people. 35,000. Yeah. There's a whole lot of people there. So, man, I had a great game. I hit 2 home runs. I hit one to tie the game. And then I hit one, I want to say, to give us a lead. And it might have been like that. I want to say I hit a 3-run home run, I think. But I had a great game. Hey, we won. We celebrated. And, man, that was a great experience for me, you know. And I was like, dang, I'm glad I came because we beat them in Cuba. You know, they were hey, they did not like that. I can tell you that right now, man. I mean, they flicking our bus off. They hated that. You know, we met people down there that were good to us. We had a good experience. And, man, it was a great experience for me to be a part of the USA team to do that. I cherished that moment. Even though I wasn't in the big leagues at the time, I cherished that moment.
Yeah, that definitely. That's huge, man. And I remember, I think, I don't know if I texted you or called you whenever I got called up that September in 06, and you said you had just got done playing with Team USA. This was early September, like, I don't know the exact day, but it was in September, and you had mentioned that. But to say that you went through that on that roller coaster ride, 2006, start at Double A, then you go to Triple A, you get that call up to the big leagues for 2 games, get sent down, join Team USA, starting to settle in to get ready to go to Cuba, you get called back up again. Damn, I'm in the air, no way of knowing. I land, I go through all of this stuff with the crowd, carry my own bags, just to get the news that we traded for somebody. We got to send you back down. For you mentally, I know for myself, I went through some stuff mentally that took me off of my game, and it shortened my career here in the States. The fact that you was able to stay glued in mentally, bro, that was huge, because you could have easily allowed that to distract you. And, yeah, you were mad, but you took all of that energy and applied it to your game to go out there and compete. Not everybody can handle that. That's where these mental health issues come into play, when guys can't handle the mental side of the game, or some guys that fail can't handle failure. But we're talking the business side. The business side of the game was controlling what you did at the big league level. You didn't let it discourage you. And then you got called back up in September that year, ended up making a squad in 07, playing the whole year as a big leaguer. And then you became part of a trade that offseason.
I did.
Talk about that. I know you had your time with Philly, and you got to play in 07 for the whole year. Talk about, you know, settling in as a Philly. You said it was a great organization. Good people. I was around some of those same guys. Charlie Manuelman, the best manager I never played for. You know, you had J. Rowe, you had Ryan Howard, you had so many guys, man. Shane Victorino, a bunch of guys, Chase Utley. Talk about that bittersweet moment when you found out you got traded in 2000, in the offseason of 2007.
So for me, it was more of a sweet moment because where I was getting traded to. So
yeah, you went back to the hometown, Houston.
Yeah, so it was crazy though because I was at one of my friend's house playing NBA Live, and you know, it was at nighttime, and I get a call from a Pennsylvania number while I'm at an apartment.
Yeah.
I get a call from Pennsylvania number and I don't answer. You know, I'm like, man, who's just calling me? You know, I don't know the number. You know what I mean?
Yeah, so about to answer that.
I hit the stop button and, you know, put it down, get to playing the game again. It called me back like 3 minutes later, you know, and it was like, oh, man, let me answer this. Just who is this? You know what I mean? I knew I didn't know that number. It wasn't plugged in my phone. So
yeah,
answer it and like, hello. And they was like, hey, Michael, you know, I'm like, what's that? I said, who is this? Like, this is Ruben Amar Jr. I was like,
again.
I know he on the phone. Like, he just called to see what I'm doing. I know that much, you know. So I'm like, okay, what's going on, Ruben? He's like, hey, man, I just wanted you to know it's probably about to air either tomorrow, probably tomorrow, that you just got traded. I said, oh, really? He was like, yeah, we just traded you to the Astros. I'm like, oh, my goodness. What? You know, he's like, yeah, we traded you for Brad Lynch. You know, we felt like it was a good trade. I was like, okay, you know, cool. You know, we ended up getting on the phone. And so the first call I called is I called my dad. I go back in the house first. And they was like, what's up, Mike? You know, I just got traded, y'all. These homeboys I didn't grow up with since I was 16 years old. They was like, what? You got traded too? I said, y'all ain't going to get it. I say Houston, they start running around the apartment. You know, they going crazy. So I'm like, oh man, I say, man, this is crazy. And so after that, I called my daddy. I'm like, daddy, what's going on, Mike? How you doing? You all right? I'm like, yeah, I'm cool. But I got some information. Like, what? You know, a father here, you know, what's going on?
Especially at that time of night.
Yeah, exactly. You know, it wasn't real late, but it was late enough, you know.
Yeah.
It was like I was like, I just got traded. Oh, really? To who? I said, guess. He was so ecstatic. He couldn't even guess. I don't know, Mike. Just tell me. You know, he'd get mad. I say, to Houston. He said, are you serious, Mike? You got traded to Houston? I say, yes. And so, for me, all these emotions are coming together. Like, I'm going to play for my hometown. I done went to college here. I played high school ball here. And now I'm getting a chance to play for my hometown team. That don't happen every day, man.
Yeah.
I didn't know what to feel. You know what I mean? I'm like, man, this is crazy. You know, I know a lot of people here. I don't know how many people are going to be asking me for
tickets. Yeah, that's the thing right there. All
this stuff going through my head, Shane. I'm just like, man, this is crazy. And I'll tell you another thing. I was about to get traded halfway through the year in Philly, but I hurt my ankle in Chicago. Running over in Chicago, they had a
touchdown
on the side.
The bullpen,
sprained my ankle, Shane, and they didn't trade me. So it ended up happening in the offseason. And once again, I come back to like, I didn't have that many at bats my first year with Phil. I probably had, for the whole year, I had like 125 at bats.
Yeah.
You know, that's not a lot for a whole season for somebody who's playing all the time. And man, I tell you what, that first season in Houston was different for me. I struggled with just the only pitch people would throw me for the most part, two seam fastball. Saying I probably rolled over to the second base 100 times. God, dog, man, how many times I'm gonna do this? You know, and so my goal after my first year was to get that down pat. I don't know if you know, but I went to play winter ball after that in the Dominican.
I remember that.
I played for Aguilas, you know, and my biggest thing was to learn how to stay inside the ball. That was my biggest thing. I was like, I'm going to learn how to stay inside the ball. And when I go back next year, I'm going to do what I know I can do. And from there, that year is when my career took off. I won my first stolen base title. I won my first gold glove. I was named the MVP team of the team and with the Astros. And that put me on the map, man. And that's where I made my noise. And it was a great learning experience in Dominican for me.
Yeah, that's huge because you facing – those guys, the fans there don't get to see them play when they come to the States. So they get to play in front of their hometown people. So those, especially the pitchers, they're gonna try to show out. So you're seeing everybody's best stuff every single night. So you better have it on your mind as a hitter to go up there looking to do something.
You better they're gonna show out, and people wonder why, like, the Latinos, when they come over here, they play like the play with their flair. Because over there, that's how they play. You know, that's normal over there. Like that's a part of the game. So you can't expect them to just come over here and not be who they are. You know what I mean? That's what they do over there, you know?
Oh, yeah.
And add some flair to the game. Like, you know, over there, the pitchers don't get mad at the hitters for doing it. The hitters don't get mad at the pitchers for doing it.
No.
It's just a way of playing baseball. So, and you have some big leaguers playing. Hanley was playing over there.
Oh, yeah. And everybody.
Over there. Andrew Jones came over there and played. I mean, everybody was over there playing, man. I was like, golly. Robinson was down there playing when I was playing. I was like, man, yeah, they
down big time. Here, it's big time baseball, and those folks out there look up to that. So you said you went down there. And then 2009, you put some things together, got that gold glove, stolen base title, team MVP, a lot of things like that. Then you roll into 2010, you get that first All-Star, appearance, man. How did that feel? And I think 2010, you, Carl, CY, Chris Young, y'all all were All-Stars out of H-Town, man. Tell me how Pops felt, because you and Carl, he coached y'all for a long time. Now you got two Major League All-Stars.
I asked my daddy that. He said, how I feel to have two Major League All-Stars that you coached in Little League. He's like, man, this is crazy. Because he just, you know, it's just crazy to see, even when we played against each other in the regular season.
Like, yeah.
We played in Little League, not high school. We was on a Little League team. You come to my house all the time. Does anybody know him from the inner city of Houston? He from Hardy. And he was coming over there all the time, him and his brother. They come over there, stay the night all the time. And it's like, man, this is a dream, you know, and it's actually happening to get in an All-Star game.
Yeah, bro.
Oh, man. I only got one at bat the All-Star game. I struck out, you know. I remember that. I was like, oh, man. I was used to playing every day. And once I came off that bench, it's
different. It was cold.
But you're around the best players of all of in Major League Baseball, man. I was Pujols, you know, whoever you want to name, man. They all there. Jeter, Carl, Josh Hamilton, CC Sabathia, all these players are there, and you are right next to them, and you in that caliber with them, man. And it's a dream come true.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
You feel like a rookie again when you get there because you're around all that. You got these 10-time All-Stars. You just sitting there like, man, this is my first time, so I'm going to just, you know.
Soak it all in.
I'm going to soak it all in, go to the home run derby. And I think that was a very good experience for me. Because at that time, right before the All-Star game, I was struggling a little bit. I had started out high, but I started struggling. But I picked it back up. I ended around by 265 or so. But what made it even better, I won my second gold glove. My second gold glove that year. And I won my second stolen base title that year. And it was big for me because going into that next year is when I felt like I had learned a lot about learning how to adjust sometimes when you're not knowing what. What people don't understand about baseball is the higher, like, you know, even from a pitcher standpoint, the higher you get up as you play, you know, you're going to go through some rough spots in the season. You know, it's not going to be like when you're in Little League.
It's not a breeze, buddy.
It's not a breeze. Everybody's good. This is the best of the best, you know. So everybody's good. You know, even when, like I tell people, the difference between football, basketball, and baseball is in basketball, you know, if you shoot the shot, you let it go. Come off your hand right, most likely it's gonna go in. Football, if a quarterback throws it to the wide receiver the right way, you know, at that level in the NFL, they're probably gonna catch it. If it's in the right route, they're gonna catch it. Bam, touchdown. Baseball, pitcher can throw that ball right there. I can hit it on the screw, Shane. I mean, bam! It go right to somebody.
Right to somebody.
Wow. And guess what? You got nothing to show. All you hear in the dugout. Good swing, man.
Good swing.
You know what I mean? Yeah.
That's an offer. That's an offer, though. Shit.
That's an offer, you know? And so the mental toughness of baseball is totally different than any other sport to me, you know?
Hell yeah. I'm with you. It's a different dynamic for you now. You put together probably some of your best seasons as a major league ball player in your hometown, knowing that you might have people pulling from left and right. you know, every angle that you could think of, whether it's tickets, hey, Mike, we having a party, we want you to make this appearance, or whatever it is, man, sign these cards, take a picture of my son, come here, come there. You was able to maintain that focus and concentration through all of that, whatever it is that you were going through, you know, that from the outside that were coming at you in different ways, you were able to focus and play some of your best baseball, man. That's an attribute to you. Again, we going back to the mental side of the game where you started preparing. You always knew how to prepare, and you understood how to work to get better. So to do that, man, I don't know how many people can do that in their hometown. Stay focused for that amount of time and actually go out there and produce. And then you had your boy Jason Bourgeois for a couple of years, huh? He joined the Astros too. That was kind of cool, man, to have two hometown boys playing on the same team at the same time.
Little league too, you know. And it was just like, man, this is crazy, you know. I know his dad felt the same way. And it's almost like you can't believe it, almost, you know.
Yeah, I mean, dog, you think you might have talked about that in the yard or in the dugout at a game, man. What if we play for the Astros one day? But you're never thinking like, hey, yeah, that's gonna happen. You know what I'm saying? Then it happened. You know,
I didn't. You know, people asked me what was my team growing up, and I'm like, I don't really think I had a team. I just looked at playing baseball as I loved it.
Yeah.
You know, then it didn't cross my mind that I was gonna play for the Astros. Like, what? You know, it just never crossed my mind. And you know, playing against Carl and playing with Jason, like, man, that's almost like, you know, that's a dream come true. And like you said. Having to go through everything when you're playing in your hometown, just like LeBron did, man, that's why I attribute to him. I know all the stuff you have to go through, appearances.
Yeah.
People want this. You're out to eat with your people. People are always coming up to you. You know, you can't even sit down and eat right, you know, if you want to. You everybody asks, man, you show, if they didn't know you, then, man, you look familiar, man. Well,
yeah.
I seen you. Like, oh, man, I don't know where you seen me.
I don't know, maybe I'm from here, so.
You know, we went to school together or something, you know. It's just something you have to make up, but. Like you said, the mental toughness of it is tough. And the next year in 2011, I'm actually having a great year. I thought I should have made the All-Star team then. It was just going to be me and Hunter. And then Hunter made it, which was good. But we were in last place. So, when you're only in last place, you only get one
guy. You might get one guy.
You know, so it was – which he was doing great, too. We both were having a great year. We always would tell each other, like, man, I know it's going to be one of us to make it. You know, whoever makes it. Salute. You
salute.
Know what I mean? We always told each other, man, you could have made it too. We always told each other that either way. And but I remember, you know, we going through that year, and me and him are having good years. We actually lead from being like the combination of who scored the most runs and drove in the most runs. Me and him are like second to third. They had Adrian Gonzalez up there with Ellsbury, and it was somebody else up there as well. But we were having a good year, but our team wasn't good. You know, we didn't have great pitching. You know, we had a few good players, but not a great team. You know,
yeah.
The team is what we're in at the end of the day. So we're getting about towards the middle of the year, and both of us are starting to hear trade rumors every day. Every day. We both hearing trade rumors every day. And lo and behold, Shane, we're in Milwaukee. And me and him are warming up in like the fourth inning. Hunter, come here. I know they ain't pulling him out for nobody for no reason. Like, he played, you know. So I'm like, what's going on? You know what I mean? Oh, man, he got traded. And he got traded. I was like, I know I'm right behind. I know I'm next, you know.
Yeah.
Like, so the next morning, I end up getting traded. I talked to Ed Wade. Shout out to Ed Wade, too, because, man, he really gave me a chance. A lot of people don't know with Philly, he really – drafted, and him and Mike Arbuckle and Morita really built that team, man.
Yeah.
From the ground up, they with J. Rowe, Ryan Howard. I mean, Utley. He drafted these players. Cole Hamels, Gavin,
a lot of cats.
All these players he drafted, you know, and he gave us a chance to play, you know, and but he drafted me. He brought me over to Houston, gave me the opportunity, and he told me, like, I don't really want to trade you, but. I have no choice. I said, yeah, I told him on the palms of the head, I understand the business, you know. Well, one thing about you know, when you're a kid playing, you know, you're playing for the fun of the game.
Yeah.
As you grow older, as a business side that you have to put into play, a lot of times that you don't want to put into play, but it's part of you know, and you have to understand that as you keep going, you know.
I can definitely relate, and I think the fact that you had the good upbringing and things like that, and you went to Philly, a team that has some vets, some guys that knew their way around the block, helped you with that. I can say myself, I was on a younger team with the Pirates, and we were too close in age. I didn't have any veteran guys per se to go to help me with that side of it. And for me, that business side kind of got me, and it took me off of my game from the mental standpoint. And I just kind of fell by the wayside with that. But the fact that you were able to stay focused on those things and realize certain things and understand those things, it definitely helped you, especially in Houston. And then now you're traded. You went from Houston to where, ATL?
Yeah, I was Houston to ATL. Yeah. So I'm going to get my chance to really play on a team that's really thriving for the first time, you know. Yeah. And I get there, and you know, you got Chipper, you got Freddie Freeman, Jason Hayward, but man, when I tell you this team was one of the most welcoming teams that I was on, man, like, because, you know, as you know, with every team, there's a different look, different culture. People do different ways. But one thing I recognized about them is that, like, they were team-oriented. You know, like, it was when people walked into the clubhouse, they shook each other's hand every day. You know, it was always a dapping up. What's going on, man? You all right? You good? You good? You know, I'm like, damn, I'm not used to that. Like, we just go to our locker, everybody just get dressed. They weren't doing none of that, you know, but they was doing this on this team. But as you know, Atlanta's been good for years and years and years.
The culture.
That culture, you know. So I'm seeing things and I'm learning as I go. And, you know, I'm watching, you know. So I get on a team that I'm, you know, I love to win. So I get on a team that I have a chance to go to the playoffs, right, Shane? So we cruising through the second half of the season and about nine games up. And we hit a wall. I mean, we can't win. But I never forget one game we was playing in Miami, and we up going into the last inning, up by a run with two outs. Dude hits a ball. You know, in Miami, the old stadium, you know, it was open.
Yeah, that dome, right? It was open?
Yeah, it was the open one.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, the football stadium.
A dude hits a ball to Chipper in the lights. He can't see it. Like, he has no chance of seeing it, so he tried to block it off. Nothing he could do about it. Ball drop. Next battle, Omar Infante come up. Home run. We lose. We got to, you know, this is towards the end of the season, and we're up like nine games on the Cardinals. And we go into St. Louis like two series later. We go in there. We playing them again. We got them in the ninth inning. Again. Somebody hits had a hit, and then Pujols comes up. Kimbrel throws him. I still remember it's a curveball. We got a little bit of a shift on him. He kind of hesitates as he hits. He kind of, when he does, he hits, but he's such a good hand-eye coordination hitter. He can still hit like that. He kind of hesitated because he thought it was going to be a fastball, and to get ready, and he stopped. Yeah. Hit the ball down the right field line.
The machine.
Oh, my goodness, man. And we lose the game. And we cannot win. We go to three games left. We got to win one game against the Phillies. They already in the playoffs.
Yeah.
I'm playing against Hunter now too, because Hunter playing with the Phillies. We just were teammates 2 months ago. Now we fighting against each other. Man, we lose the first two games. We get to the last game. We battling them. We in like the 11th inning, 5-5. Hunter hits like a broken bat, shattered bat. Not like just broken, shattered bat. 15 hopper in between first and second, and a man stole from second, man. And we lose game 6-5. They cut, and we out the playoffs. Everybody remember Boston collapsing? We collapsed too. We collapsed just the same. That was the first time I was like, oh my goodness, like. That was a bad collapse, you know, and I couldn't wait for the next season to get started.
Because of that sour taste in your mouth. That's crazy. That's the year. That was, what, 2011? 2011. Yeah. That's when the Cardinals, they won the World Series that year. The Cardinals ended up winning it all. That's crazy how the game goes, man. It's a funny game, baseball. Things don't always go the way you think they would. So you go back 2012, you go back to Atlanta, right?
Well, we're going into 2012 season, and I'm with Atlanta for the first time for a full season now. We have a lot of talent on our team, from me and Prado to Jason Hayward to Freddie Freeman to Chipper Jones. This is going to be his last year, right? This is like the everybody coming out every weekend.
Every game, yeah. You
know what I mean? So we got a very talented team with Ugla on the team. Simmons is eventually
taking stop.
Stop, yes. You know, we got a very talented team with Campbell. You know, that 7th, 8th inning, 8th, 9th inning was over with. We had O'Flaherty and Ventures coming in the 8th inning.
Y'all had some guys over there.
Oh, we had some guys. Then Campbell shut it down in the 9th. So, we this is the time, like, I'm like, man, I love this team. You know, like, we have a very talented team. And, you know, we get out the gates a little slow. Once again, I get out the gates a little slow.
Of course, that's been the theme of the podcast, huh?
And slow start. The crazy thing about me, and it's not to, like, I'm not trying to brag on this situation, but it was like, it's like whenever, like, as a leadoff hitter, if I started out slow, it seemed like offensively we started out slow.
Yeah.
You know, but as I picked it up, we got going.
Team picked it up.
It's just how it rolled for me. It's how it rolled for our team. So, but as I picked it up, it probably took me about the fourth series or so, something like that. And I started picking it up, and I picked it up fast. You know, like I was going at it fast. I was going into the All-Star break, man. I ended up making my second All-Star game that year. And going into the All-Star, I think I was leading in like three or four categories almost. Hits, runs, stolen bases. And once again, I make an All-Star game. So this All-Star game is actually different for me because it's my second one, and I kind of got a feel for it for the first time. And I'm going to tell you what made this one way different and way better for me is that I got to bring my son to All-Star.
That's cool.
And, you know, like, I wanted him to always remember that memory, you know.
That's
like,
cool.
We got pictures of it. He sat at the podium with me when I had to do interviews. He was with me the whole time.
Yeah, that's what's up. That's what's up.
I cherished that moment, you know, like I did. And I was with him, like, the whole time. I didn't want him to go nowhere. I wanted him to be with me. Unless I had to go on the field and practice. Other than that,
he was with you.
I don't care if we're doing interviews or not. I want you to be with me.
That's what's up, man. That's what it's all about, man. You get that opportunity to be an All-Star again. You said you know your way around the block a little bit because you had been before. And then speaking on you starting a little slow that year, but that's why they say in this game it's a marathon, not a sprint. So you understood that term even back then as well.
No doubt about it. And I, like you said, the mental toughness of playing baseball, man. Like I always want to tell kids, like, man, if you can play, you know, be confident that you can play. You know, even if you start out slow, be confident, man. When you step in that box or you step on that mound, regardless, you know, just like what you did, like, you got to know that you can play. Like you said, the mental part of the game is way bigger than the physical. I just want to say this because I feel that, like, you know, you done threw a 100 balls to the outside corner of the plate, 100 balls to the inside corner of the plate. I done hit 5,000 balls off the tee, and I done practiced as much as you can practice, you know. It has nothing to do with practice. I mean, of course you have to work, but it has nothing to do with it. It's up here, man. It's what you believe, you know? Like, it's what you believe. You're going to put the work in, but, like, I heard – I don't know if you got to watch the Last Dance about Michael Jordan.
Oh, yeah, definitely watched every episode.
The reporter said something that was very important to me, and he was like, you know, what separates Jordan from every other superstar, he said it wasn't his jump shot, it wasn't his ability to jump, it wasn't his ability to run fast or – whatever, all the athletic abilities that he had good big hands that way he can palm the ball and do all this. It had nothing to do with anything. He said it was the fact that he was present, he was seen, and he was, you knew his aura was there.
Yeah.
He believed, man. He believed. You know, if anybody ever gets a chance to look at this, he against the Jazz when he plays, the last sequence where he makes the shot. Then he comes down to steal the ball from Karl Malone. And then he comes back and makes the shot again and wins the game, right? So after the game is over with, he finds Phil Jackson. And Phil Jackson said, oh, that was a beautiful, beautiful sequence, Jordan. And if you listen to him, he said a very important thing. He's like, I had faith, Phil. I had faith. And just think about that, though, Shane. You in game six on the road.
Yeah, in Utah,
all this stuff. And you know you're going to win. And it ain't even going through your process that you're going to lose. I got faith, man. And that's what I tell kids, like, have the confidence that you know that you're going to do it. Thank God first and believe that you're going to – God wants you to believe that you're going to do it.
Yeah.
You can't go out there and kind of doubt it. I did that before. But I know that – and guess what? I didn't succeed when I did it because I didn't – but when I believe,
it happened.
You know, you can't think that you can't do it, man. I'm telling you. Because it's going to – you know, as I know, you're going to believe one time and it's not going to happen. That's okay. All right. Believe again. You have to have confidence when you're out there.
And that's what it's all about. And we speaking on that and talking. It's been slow starts. It's been the mental side. That's been the theme of us today. But you talking about how Jordan thought and approached the game, how you approached the game. And we're going to get into the fact that you made the All-Star team again with ATL. You finished out the year. Okay, now you're a free agent. Now talk about how mentally tough you had to be, because that's the time I was back. I was in Houston living in the off season. I finished my first year in Korea overseas. I come to Houston. I'm with you. I'm working out. You hitting with Sid. Shout out to Sid.
Yeah.
And I'm working out next door with Heidi with the metal chapter. Heidi and Barry. Shout out to them too with the metal chapter. And man, we sitting this December. Man, Mike, what's up, man? You ain't signed yet. What's going on, bro? You just came off a year like that, bro. You've been consistent over the last 4 years, bro. Consistently going out there, doing your thing over the last 4 years. And now nobody want to offer you that contract like the one that you deserve.
Yes.
Talk about how you was able to stay focused and keep your eye on the prize going through that free agency and not getting the love that you thought you deserved from a particular organization.
So for me, this free agency process was different than most of everybody else. You remember, they had that attachment to your name for the first time.
I didn't know that.
1 year deal they can offer you at 12 or 13. Started at 12 or 13 million. Nowadays, it's like 20 million now for 1 year. But at that time, it was like 12. This is the first year of going through this whole process. So what that says is if a team offers you a deal, they lose their pick. You know, especially if they got the top 10 pick, they lose their, you know, and teams didn't want to lose their pick, you know, in the top 10 pick, they think that dude going to be one of their dudes coming up in the process, you know. So I'm projected to go to Washington. I can go back to Atlanta. Washington, Atlanta, Cincinnati. I didn't even think Cleveland was in the picture at the time. I had heard nothing about it. I even heard Houston. I heard
been in the National League. Yeah, been in the National League your whole career. So,
I'm hearing all these teams, Shane. I'm looking like, so, Washington ended up trading for a center fielder, and Atlanta signed BJ.
BJ, I remember that.
Somebody else traded for a center fielder because it was Ben Revere and Danoa Span that got traded. Two center fielders off one team got traded. So this team, Minnesota didn't even have a center fielder at the time.
Yeah.
They didn't care less. They weren't trying to win it anyway. they left. And both of them was like, I want to say Ben. Did Ben go to the
– He might have went to the Phillies, huh?
That's what it was. Yeah. The Phillies were involved. So both of them teams – go and get somebody, and I'm like, oh, my goodness. So by that drove my value down. Now I've heard rumors of stuff that was happening. You know, I don't know. I can't put my finger on it, but I have to be patient in this situation. I'm like, oh, my goodness. I'd have worked all this time.
Yeah, but after putting together them seasons, man, come on, bro.
Yeah, I know. You know, that's how I say, man. You know. And it's like, God, damn, man. I gotta live with this. So – I actually, you know, end up signing with Cleveland. You know, I mean, we come all the way down to like a week before spring training.
Yeah, I was about to leave to go back overseas when you signed.
Yes. So I ended up signing 4 years, $48 million with them. You know, did I feel like I could get more at that time? Of course I did.
Of course.
You know, but it happened the way it happened. You know, you can't erase history. You know, when it happened, it happened. All you can do is adjust. So end up signing with Cleveland. And the team that we had there was very, very talented. Swisher was there. You had Jason Kipnis there. You had Michael Brantley there. You had Drubal Cabrera there. Drew Stubbs was there. We had Kluber play at the time, but Kluber wasn't Kluber at the time yet.
He was coming up.
I'll tell you,
Carrasco.
Yeah, Carlos Carrasco was there. We had Justin Masterson at the time. So we had some talent on this team.
Yeah.
That free agent process was a very, very tough process for me. You know, I was thankful I got what I got because of how it happened over time, you know. And it put me to where, like, I could live comfortably and I could do some things. And I just had to adjust as I went. But one thing it did teach me was trying to learn how to have patience and adjust on the fly. Like, you don't know all the time what happened, man, you know. You just don't, you know. And it didn't. And things didn't happen like I wanted it to happen. I'll be honest with you. But that's the way I had to play it. What else I was going to do, you know. Exactly, you know, and I didn't have that many teams after me, really. The Mets, too, were after me kind of tough, though. They were one other team that I thought I might have went to. And Cleveland came in at the last minute, you know, and that deal was 4-48 with a 5-60 at the end. So,
yeah, they had an option on that.
They had an option, a vested option, you know, where you have a certain amount of bats, you know. I don't know if I want to own that because you know how that go at times.
Yeah, they might sit you for a couple games to make sure you don't get the MVP.
So, but I get to Cleveland and I love this team because this team is like, I'm gonna tell you something about that team. That team, they didn't care who you were. We didn't care who you were. Everybody was available to get ranked on. Ranked on is getting talked about.
So yeah, of course.
We had to lose, and we were a good team. Now we were. If we were hot, we were very good. But if we were bad, anybody can run in there and beat us. But if we were on point, you didn't want to see us. I don't care who you were. So I get there my first year, and a lot of people don't know this, but we in the playoff hunt. It's us in Detroit. You know, people don't really think that we're going to be that good, but we end up shocking a lot of people, man. And it's us in Detroit coming down to the end. But Detroit kind of pulls away from us a little bit, like by 5 or 6 games. So we get to last 11 games, Shane. Last 13 games. We lose a game. So we got 12 games left. We end up losing another game. But if we lose one more game, I want to say Texas takes over. Either Texas or Tampa Bay. They take over our spot. So we lose that game. I call a meeting in the weight room. And, you know, I'm letting my competitive nature out. Like, hey, we not going out like this. I don't care nothing about none of the fundamentals, all that other stuff. We got to come out here and compete. We acting like we scared. We ain't playing like we've been playing. And I let it all out in the weight room. Like you said, once I speak, I let it be known. You know, I'm speaking. You know what I mean? And we in the weight room. You can ask anybody that was on that team. You know, we in the weight room talking. And I'm the only one that's talking. They all in the back of the weight room, I'm talking. I'm telling them, hey, we got to compete. Stop acting like we out there scared. Can't nobody mess with us if we on point. Let's go out there and let you know, I'm talking man talk. You know what
for
I mean?
Sure.
we talking. And after I say what I say, I just walk out the weight room. You know what I'm saying? Everybody, we all follow. We went 11 straight. We don't lose. We don't lose, man. The last game of the against Minnesota, we got the game in hand. We up like 5-1. But my mind, man, I'm a competitor once again. So my mind, I get on. I'm leading off. Switch is hitting behind me. I get on. I remember this whole sequence. I hit it up the middle. I get on first. I steal. He fouls it off. Dang it, Swish.
You know what I mean? Take that.
Easy, you know what I mean? So I go back to first. Dude throws a ball, 1-1 count. So I wait, I steal again. Bam, I go again. My second step, Shane, I hear something pop. You know, I limp all the way to second. I'm like, oh my goodness. I think Rajay knows about this because I think he had the same surgery. Rajay, Jose Reyes had the same surgery. Andre Johnson, a wide receiver, had the same surgery. So it's a tendon that they use. They use for Tommy John. I tore that in my hamstring, but I could feel it, man. Like, I'm like, oh, what was that? You know what I mean? Like, I felt that. You know what I mean? And but it don't hurt bad. So I walked. They tagged me out. I walked in the dugout. They said, "Man, you all right?" I'm like, "Man, I don't know." So we end up winning the game. We got to wait for the play-in game with the Rangers and the Rays. The Rays end up winning. So we playing them, you know. And I got like 48 hours like to know like if I'm going to play or not.
You're going to play or not.
So I try to do everything, get a massage. I try to take all the medicine I can to get ready to play. And I go out there and test it out, sprint. Yeah, I can go. I was like, you can go. Yeah, I'm going to do it. Yeah, just my nature. I'm like, I got to try.
You're in the playoffs. So you're trying to do your thing.
You know, so I get in there, man, and Shane, I'm hurting. The first play of the game just hit to me. David Jesus. I go back on the ball, and I end up catching it, but I barely get there. And this is a ball like, I catch this, you know, so my eyes.
Yeah.
And I run it. And Brandon looked at me like, just looked like, you're okay? He knew it, and I just knew I wasn't okay. But I played through it, but we ended up losing. I was 0-4 with 2K, and I just couldn't. When I tried, it was my left hamstring. So whenever I was swinging, I'm left-handed, my back leg.
Yeah, that back leg.
You know, I would try, but I couldn't. And you know, we ended up losing the game. We ended up having surgery on that. And the doctor told me that he was going to tell eventually. He's like, whether it tore right now or a year from now, he said eventually he was going to tell.
It was going to happen.
Yeah, he said it's over time. And to take it back, you know, I don't know if you remember 2012, we lost the playoff game to the wild card game too. And that was the one where that fly ball, they ruled it up. Infield fly rule. It was in the outfield.
Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, and that changed that whole dynamic of that game. But, you know, I just wanted to mention that. I had to go back and mention that. I had good luck with the playoff games, the one to play a game. So we ended up losing in 2013, which was, you know, I had an okay year, but I actually didn't start out too bad that year. This is one of the years I actually started out. Yeah.
And had a little money in your pocket. Had a little security.
Oh man! And so with that said, I end up going, you know, getting surgery after the season's over with, and end up doing some rehabbing. And it cuts into my working out. You know, like I'm working out, can't run as much because I'm rehabbing that tendon. And man, I'm asking the guy that I'm rehabbing with, like, man, Russ Payne, that was his name. Very good known physician here. And I'm asking him, like, man, do I have any scar tissue? Like, what's going on? You know, like, I don't, you know, usually you have scar tissue after
injury.
And then, all right, now we getting back. Lo and behold, I get spring training. I have a hard workout. I go to the strength and conditioning coaching. I'm like, I was having, you know, I had a day off that day to where I wasn't playing. So I'm like, hey, look, I want you to push me to my limit. You know what I mean? I want you to push me today. We out there running. We doing all type of drills, everything, Shane. We doing it all. So I do it. I have a good workout. I feel good, you know. I feel good, you know. So next day I'm playing the Giants. Go to the Giants Stadium in Arizona. We got spring training and get there facing Tim Hudson. I hadn't – spring training I never was a good start at spring training. I always looked terrible anyway.
Yeah.
And I finally catch my rhythm. I hit a curveball in the right field, and I'm on first. So I want to say Swish might have been hitting behind me, and he hit it to right field. And I'm going first to third, and I hear the scar tissue breaking up.
Like it happened again, huh? Like it happened again.
Oh man! Oh man! I was like, oh my goodness! So I'm. You know, I sit out. I had to sit out for a few weeks and get that healed. I go to rehab. You know, one thing I noticed about the rehab is I went down to AAA, AA and AAA to rehab. And I'm like, man, this game is so slow to me. Like, you know what I mean? Because I didn't play. And I'm like, dang, this is different. And I finally get ready to where my hamstring's strong enough to go back up and play. And I get up there, Shane, and the game seemed so fast to me. Dog, I gotta get rid of the real spring training. I'm like, oh my goodness, you know what I mean? Oh man, but you know when you play for someone for so long, you don't even notice that the game is that fast.
Nah, it's second nature.
Nature to you, you know. And I'm like, man, I'm doing my thing, but I get back to my normal speed. You know, I'm starting to get back to normal. I'm getting better. I'm hovering around 280. All of a sudden, I start taking off. I got real hot in Baltimore. End up leaving Baltimore. I'm hitting over 300. You know, I'm feeling good again. You know,
yeah.
Feeling myself. Lo and behold, I'm going for a little while. I hit a couple home runs. I'm getting another rhythm. The scar tissue hit again. So this whole year, man, I'm battling this hamstring up and down, and I'm battling it tough, you know. And I'm just part of my career. That's how it goes. Yeah.
But you're a guy that needs your hammies. You're a guy that runs. You're a guy that goes all out.
I need it. So up and down, and I come back at the end of the year. I probably play the last 25 games or so. But, you know, I didn't get to play a consistent way throughout the whole year. I missed a lot of the year, you know. And they sat down with me, and they wanted me to work out with a track coach. I ended up working out with Leroy Burrell in the offseason. Got my legs strong. I had a very good offseason. I mean, I worked hard this off. I worked hard every offseason.
But, yeah.
You know, I put in some track work this offseason. I'm feeling good. Shane, I have my best spring training ever. Ever. I come in. I mean, Shane, you can ask anybody this spring. I am lighting the ball up. I'm anything they throw to me. I hit one home run off the rooftop up there. I'm like, what? Picked up a bat that I hadn't even been used. I forgot. One day I forgot my bat. I'm going to just use this bat. That's how I was feeling.
You was confident.
Oh, man, Shane. First at bat. I'll be way back. I'm old, man. But in my head, I'm like, man, I ain't never hit this good in spring training before, man. Like, you know, this ain't normal, you know.
I don't know. Yeah.
I usually hit good towards the end of spring training. Then I go in and lo and behold, man, 2015 had to be one of my worst seasons, like after I have established myself as And I mean, I put in all type of work in the offseason. So I couldn't get going with the chain. I had never had a season like this. I'm like, oh my goodness, man. And so I get traded in the middle of that season to Atlanta. Like a little bit after the All-Star break, I get traded.
Went back to Atlanta?
Back to Atlanta. You know, and I get to Atlanta and I'm hitting all type of balls hard, Shane. So Jace Peterson one day, we going out in the field at bat. I had just lined out. I mean, hit another line shot. He was like, I just don't understand how you like this. I'm like, what you mean? He's like, I done seen you hit at least 10 to 15 line drives, like on the screws, and every one of them got caught. I was like, well, I mean, you know, when you're young, you're in that throwing, you know, you mad.
Yeah.
You know, I'm like, I mean, what I'm going to do about it? You know what I mean? Like, I can't.
Can't do nothing.
I can't do nothing. You see me working. I'm in here and I'm, you know, I'm frustrated, but I'm trying to hold it in because I'm just like, man, this is, you know, I ain't never experienced nothing like this.
Yeah.
And I just chalked that season up and just, once it was over with, I just bagged it up and just threw it away. Like, just, I'm over with. Let me go take a trip. Let me go enjoy myself. That's over with. You know, I couldn't do nothing about it. What was good for me is that I knew I put in the work. Like, it wasn't like I went into the season where I didn't work or I put in. It wasn't no, like I didn't train or nothing like that. So the next season, I come into spring training, and I'm in with Atlanta. You know, I'm another good, putting in a lot of work again. I'm always putting in the work. I never, ever, for any baseball player, any athlete, I never, ever, not once came into spring training and not been in good shape, in great shape. I even take it to another level when I get to spring training because I got 8 more weeks, and I try to get into baseball shape with weightlifting shape to be as strong as I could possibly be.
Yeah.
Combining the both. I mean, because baseball shape is different than weightlifting shape. But I combine both of them, and I go in there with game shape, being ready for the season. So I come in like I always do, and, you know, I'm going into my 10th year now. And this is my 11th season. It's my 11th season.
You would say, yeah, 11, yeah, 2016.
And that's my 11th season. But I go into spring training. I'm having an okay spring training. And lo and behold, Freddie called me into the office. He has tears in his eyes. So, Freddie, you know what I mean? What was going on? I see the GM in here. You know, this is a hard decision for us, but we got to release you. I had never been through this yet. I'm like, what? Yeah. You know, I'm like, oh, my God. I was a for sure to make the team anyways, you know. So I'm going through spring training like a normal spring training. I do extra running at the end of the game, you know. I work out after the game, you know. I'm like, man, if I knew this, then I would have just played like I'm in a regular season right off the bat, you know.
Yeah.
But I did. That's how I'm thinking, you know. So, man, you know, and I just take it for what it is, you know. So, I go home, I'm a little frustrated. So, the Blue Jays let me stay in Shapiro. He ended up signing me, which I love Shapiro. I like him. Very good. Yeah. Very good. Very good president of the team. You know, he got a great team that's developing with Toronto. So I end up signing with them, and they let me stay in low A and play. You know, I'm down there with, you know, Anthony Alford, all the young players that's coming along, you know. So I get to know them. We get to chill, and, you know, they give me a month. I play pretty good. And, you know, in low A, it's low A. You know, I'm not –
yeah.
I'd have been in the big leagues now playing in low A. Like, I'm playing as good as I can to get my mind going. And, but I end up taking my release because I'm like, I want them to make a decision. So end up signing with Arizona. Going to Arizona. And, you know, I played minor leagues there for probably about 2 weeks. And they end up calling me up. And, man, Shane, I catch fire right away. I'm hitting everything. I'm doing what I can. I'm having a good year so far. But I tape off a little bit, but I still did pretty good. I was productive, and I'm 33 now. So at the end, Baltimore wants me. In Arizona, we were getting our heads.
Weren't that good? Yeah.
We were getting our heads bust a shade. So I'm out there in center running every which way. Any way you can run, I'm running that way, you know. And I go to Baltimore, you know, I get traded to Baltimore. So, man, I tell you, this had to be the most relaxed clubhouse that I had ever been in saying we're going into the playoffs. I mean, we had chess boards in there. We had pool table, ping pong.
Hey, the whole nine.
All this. They're doing the whole nine. Shane, if you want to go out to BP, you can go out. If you don't want to go out, you don't have to go out.
Come on, man.
I promise you, Walker. I was like, I wish I'd have been over here the whole year. Man, I'm a vet now. You know what I mean? Like, I don't have to go out to BP. Oh, man, this is what I've been looking for. You know what I mean? Like, you know, you that long and you've been playing. And if you're not playing on nothing without any help, man, by that 10th year, you need them days where you need, you know? And it was like a perfect situation for me, man. And I was like, I'm like,
no,
we ain't gotta go out there. If you don't want to,
I ain't going.
I said, relax. I'm like, hey, I can go lift weights if I wanted to. If I didn't, they treated you like a grown man. It reminded me of when I came up, like an old school team, and I loved it, man. I like this, man. Like, I mean, I like it. They ain't make you do all that. I'm telling you, you will see about two starters out there hitting in
BP. Crazy.
We're in a playoff hunt, man. But it's so relaxed that it's so good for the veterans. You know, like, they had a veteran squad with Machado and Scope over there. You know, most of the other kids, people with like 10-year, 11-year
veterans.
Yeah. I'm telling you, Shane, it was so relaxed in the club. I was like, man.
That's crazy.
Yes, man. Very, very relaxed. And we won, though, like that. We won. You know, I had a good month over there, too. I ended up hitting, like, before the last game, I was hitting around about 360. I ended up hitting like 290 at the end, 285, because I went over for the last game.
Yeah.
I had in the more best, I was doing very well over there. So I ended up going back over there. We ended up losing in the playoffs again in the wild card game against the Blue Jays.
I remember that.
I don't understand what this wild card thing is, man. I ain't had the best of luck with that.
None at all.
No, but I end up going, end up signing back with them in spring training. This right here was the mind blower. I end up signing back, and I'm in spring training, and I come to spring training kind of late because when I sign, but I'm already in good shape anyways. Like I said, yeah. I get in there and we're doing some drills, right, Shane? We're doing these met ball drills. We got three stations set up. I'm like, man, I'm gonna go do some extra work. We got three stations. We're doing a football drill, met ball drill, and a running drill. So I get there to do the med ball. I do the football drill. Doing this route, catch a pass, and I break my finger.
Yeah, I remember that. I remember when you broke your finger.
And I broke my finger, and I've been there 2 days. I'm like, oh my goodness, man. Like, what do I do? Lo and behold, man, I don't even get to participate in spring training. I'm out 6 weeks.
Dang.
So with that being said, I'm like, man, God, I know this is going to be a struggle because I don't sign a major league contract. I signed a minor league contract.
Minor league deal, yeah.
Right, but now I'm gonna have to go to the minor league because I ain't had no at bats, you know. So, to make a long story short, I end up rehabbing, and this is the first time I was extended. I'm like, man, I don't see how y'all do this in extended. I guess only a 17, 18 year old kid could do that, man. You know, but
they happy to be a professional.
Yeah, they are. You're right. They are, no doubt about it. So I end up staying there, and me and Edwin Jackson actually are together. And shout out to EJ. That's my guy, man. And, we end up just grinding it out, and we end up AAA once we get ourselves together. So I go to AAA, play there for about 2-3 weeks, and I'm like, hey man, y'all gonna make a decision or what? Like, cause I got an opt out, Shane. I'm like, I just didn't have the. I don't know. I just didn't want to stay in the minor leagues that long doing that. You know, I had already paid my dues. You know, I'm like,
for sure.
Hey, just I'm gonna show up when the lights come on. Just believe that. You know, that's just what I'm gonna do. But they ended up not calling me up. I took my release, and I ended up signing with the Angels after that.
I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm. I ended up signing with the Angels after that because I stayed home for about a week, 2 weeks or so. And the Angels ended up calling. But me and that minor league thing, I couldn't do it no more. I was trying.
I feel you.
But I had already been, I've been playing up there for so long. And I'm like, bro, I give you 2 weeks. And Eric Chavez, he was the assistant to the general manager for the Angels at the time, I think. He came down and watched me play a series. Shane, I went off. I knew he was there. I went off, had about 5 or 6 hits, hit a home run, drove in a few runs. End up scoring the game-winning run. So I scored the game-winning run, and I felt no adrenaline. That's when I knew. I'm like, this
ain't it.
This ain't it. I can't do it, man. I already got my 10 years. I'm good. Like, I'm like, and I want to play, but it wasn't just for the money. So,
yeah.
You know, I wanted, of course, I could have made a few more million, but it was just like, man, y'all make it. You know, back, you know, when we came up, they didn't give veterans the run around like that.
No.
They gave the veterans the benefit of the doubt. And that was no more at that time, you know.
It was a new day. A lot of things had changed.
Yep. And I just, you know, after that, I said, you know what? The Angels don't call me up. I'm going to go. I give it one more chance to play. But, I go to spring training with the invite to, you know, okay, I'm trying to make the big league team. I couldn't even get an invite to spring training. I was like.
That's crazy, man, how the tide turns that quick.
That quick. But I enjoyed my career, man. I enjoyed it, Shane. I enjoyed every bit of it. You know, my son got to see me play a while. My daughter got to see me play. I had a long journey from playing 5 years old to playing 11 years in the big leagues. Man, I cherish that moment. You know, now I'm at home being a dad. And,
yeah.
businesses off the field that I work on. And like you said, I apply that to life now, you know, with my business, with real estate and other investments that I make, you know, and I'll see what my next thing is. But I want to take my time and make sure I was done with baseball.
Sure.
I didn't want to come back and do all that and try again. And, you know, I was in the
– Yeah, you're trying to hold on to something that's not really there.
Yes, you know, and I was in the weight room last offseason, and I was just in there training so I wouldn't get big, but I trained where I used to train at, you know.
Yeah.
Weights. And they see me in there doing my stuff, and I end up doing a vertical, and I jumped 36. And they was like, "Damn, you still can jump." And I'm like, "Yeah." They was like, "Man, I really think you should get one more shot at this thing." I was like, "Look, y'all."
You turn that light off, dog. You turn that light off. It's hard to flip that thing back.
I say I can't. It's hard for me to. I shouldn't have to push myself to go out there to go, you know, throw and hit and do all that every day. Like it's a work. You know, it's work out there. Yeah. You know, when you're doing that. And I say I come in here, I lift weights, and I go home. I don't go out there with y'all to go throw. I don't go out there with y'all to go hit. None of that, man. I hit like just every now and then just to mess around. But as far as like getting ready, no,
yeah, man, that ain't gonna happen.
Y'all got it, man. Y'all got it. Unless the GM was like, "Hey, Mike, we want to give you a good chance," I'd be like, "Oh, all right."
But, I'll take advantage.
Yeah, but I'm so into watching my kids play now that I don't even know. Like, you know, I would like to go work for a team. That would be very fun.
Yeah. You know?
I'm so into watching them play that I close that chapter. You know, like, I'd rather do other stuff. And I like being a businessman now. I like watching him, taking him and teaching him little things about the game. And, man, you know, it got to me one time. I was going to the free agent camp, and I was dropping him off at school, and I was coming to see him before I left.
Yeah.
Man, he was walking off, and I know my son, you know. He was trying to hold it in. I could tell from the back he didn't want me to leave. He wanted me at home with him.
Yeah.
And, you know, he was like, you could tell he was holding in it. I was like, "Bryce," you know, and he turned around and he had tears in his eyes. I was like, "Man." I was like, "Oh."
That hit you right there.
I was like, "Oh, man, I don't even know if I want to really go to the free agent camp." I ended up going, but nothing came, Nathan really came. And I played good down there. They was like, "Man, it shouldn't be no problem for you to get on those teams. At least get an invite in the spring practice." I know, but it is what it is.
It is what it is.
I went home after that week, and man, I was cool. I went home with him and started coaching, and you know, watching him play. And you know, he won't be there all the time now.
Of course.
You know, we gonna argue, but he won't be there. So I enjoy it, man, and man, I really would tell kids to pursue their dreams, you know, but also enjoy being a kid. That's the most fun time in your life, you know, like you get to enjoy being with your friends, making memories with your friends, and go on trips with your parents if you have them, or go on trips with your friends. Don't just make it all about sports at 8
all the time.
You know, like I just don't see that, you know, being in the journeys that we've been through, you know, you can ask Rajay and ask all the kids, the people that play, man, enjoy your childhood, man.
Yeah.
Enjoy it, you know, you only get one time at that.
Definitely. And we got to do that as youngsters, having other friends and doing other things. So, man, that definitely a classic episode, bro. We went back, we dug some stuff out of the vault and touched on, obviously, your long career and accomplishments that you had. Before I let you go, man, I got 5 quick questions, man. We answer them. I hammer them out. Answer them quickly as possible. Best answer that comes to mind, and then we'll shut this thing down. But I'm going to ask you, man. I know you always took care of your money and didn't really spend money and stuff like that. But was it ever a purchase you made that was like, "Damn, why did I do that?"
Well, I do. I have a Bentley, so I have to say that. But that wasn't a purchase to where I'm like, "Ugh." I feel like, yeah, I wanted it because I worked hard for it. You know, gotcha, what I mean? Like, so maybe a couple of jewelry pieces, maybe that I don't know. You know what I mean? Like, you know, but you know, I made other investments to make money. But I also think that, man, like, it's a fine line. I also think you want to save your money to learn to live for a long time and be able to do what you want to do. But I also think you should enjoy yourself too. Like, you know what I mean? You live one time. Like, you know, if we want to, I always want to take a trip with my family somewhere. Like, we're going to go enjoy ourselves. Like,
and not worry about nothing else. Just go and do what you do.
You know, money is made, like, to to spend also. You know, I want to save it for my kids, but like I heard Big Meech say one time, a lot of people say, I don't see no Brinks trucks pulling up to no funeral home. They not. Nah. You can't take it with you when you go. With you. That's it. That's it. It's made to spend, but you, of course, you don't want to spend it all, of course.
Be
no
smart
doubt.
With it.
But, man, enjoy yourself, man. Like,
for sure.
You know what I mean? Like, I don't spend it on crazy stuff every night like now. Like, you know, of course, when I was young, I like to go out. Like, I was a kid.
Yeah.
You know, I ain't going out every night now. I mean, I go here and there still, but not like I used to.
Not like that. For sure. I'm with you, man. So, I didn't even know you had jewelry, but you said maybe a couple of jewelry pieces.
I have, like, a whole host of jewelry. Like 15, 20 pieces. Now, I ain't got nothing. Like that. I got something in there, you know. I got
for
a little
sure. I was surprised though when I came to the crib, you had a new car, because I know you held on the cars for the longest. to see the Bentley and the S550 in the garage, I'm like, okay, Mike, you finally did it. You're like, yeah, because I got a little bit.
Now, I waited for a while, you know. I drove the Acura forever, you know. So
yeah,
like I said, like once you have it, man, I don't think it's wrong to spend it sometime, man. Like I don't, you know. You know, I know I pray that I don't ever run out of money, but I also know at the end of the day when you leave this earth, money, you're not taking
it. It's going to be there.
My children, but you can't take no money with you, man. It means nothing once you're in the casket. It means absolutely zero.
For sure.
You know, so you got to enjoy your life while it's here.
For sure. I appreciate that, Jim, you just dropped when it comes to that, man. People need to hear that as well, along with other stuff we talked about on this podcast. So I'm going to go with the second question, man. What's the best city or stadium you played at?
So this might shock you though, but I like Wrigley Field.
Oh, I'm with you. I would say that's one of at least my top three, top two probably.
I like the atmosphere of it. It's always packed, man. Back then, the Astros and the Cubs weren't the best teams. We always packed it out. You know? And even with the Braves, it was packed. Like it's a very great environment. The clubhouse is not big, but man, that environment is. It's fun to play in, man. I loved it. I'm not going to lie. I love it.
I can dig that one, bro. I can dig that one. So you got a young son, your baseball card or the video game, which one to you was like, all right, I know you got the gold gloves. I know you got the all-star appearances. But when you saw that baseball card or you saw yourself on the video game, I was like, man, I done did this thing. I done made it.
So for me, with him, I would say the video game because, like, last year they had an all-time Astros team.
Yeah,
I didn't expect myself to make it, but I was on there, and I made it, and he seen it, and he jumped with joy. He was like, Daddy, you was on there! You know, so for me, it was good for me to see it, but for him to see it, it brought more joy for me, you know what I mean? I like to see him, you know, he know that I accomplished something in life, and I'm steady trying to improve in life. Like, I just tell him, like, I want him to know. As a kid, you know, even if he's able to play baseball, that if he may able to make it to that level,
that which level.
I also want you to know there's a life after that, you know, and I'm figuring that out and I'm learning as I go and I'm enjoying it and you know I'm just trying to make decisions and continue to make money and continue to build it, you know. I thank God for every day I get too, man, because it's just, you know, you live life and you live it one time, you know, and that's it.
The show from Gold Glover, the young black entrepreneur, and I might be. I see you, bro.
I like that.
I got two more for you, man. I got two more for you before I let you go. So home or away? Home or away? You like playing at home or you like playing on the road?
I'm a road guy.
I'm with you. I'm a road guy too.
Yeah, I like the road. I ain't gonna lie to you. That I like it. I like the atmosphere. I like it. You know what I mean? That just
shut them folks up.
I like to shut them up, man. I like to shut them up. You know what I mean? I took pride in that. It's just I like it at home too. But if you have to choose for me,
go on the road. I got you. I can relate. I'm with you on that one too. So last question, man, because you know we've been dropping some gems and it's been a classic episode. As I said before, you know after I'm done with this, I'm gonna go ahead and go to the kitchen. So. Pre-game meal. You had a pre-game meal. Anything you like to eat or have before you went out there and balled out?
No, but I only had one thing that I always did on the way to the field. I always drank a big bottle of Smart Water.
Okay.
I wanted to be hydrated when I got out there in that sun, you know. But
that's what's up.
Then I never had a specific meal that I really ate.
Yeah, but it's some nutrition when you talk about hydrating and getting them fluids in you to have that smart water. I remember I came to the crib. I think your whole pantry is full of smart water. So
Yep, man.
So
before we go, I'm gonna bring y'all a guest on. She just walked into the building, and
I'm gonna
bring her on for her first podcast. Come on.
Let's see.
Come on. She just walked into the building, and I will present y'all with
that's the baby girl, man. Baby cutie. Girl.
And that's lady. Tell them hey. Tell them hi. Can you say hi?
How are you? She just hi. Smiling.
Can you say hi to everybody? Yeah, this is my baby girl, Bailey.
Bailey, how you doing? I met all three of the Bourn clan right here. You're the last one.
Yes, it last.
You're the last one, man. Yeah. Mike, bro. I appreciate you taking the time, man. I know you're a family man, so you took that time out to chop it up with me on the League Talk podcast, bro. Hey, bro, much love, continued success, man. Again, this is the League Talk podcast, and we're going to get up out of here, man.
And I just want love. I appreciate it. Thank you for having me on, man. This is a pleasure. And if we happen to do it again down the line, I'm ready to do it again down the line. You know you're my man. It's always one love with you, Shane. A life.
For sure, man. I love that, bro. Right back at you, bro.